is Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket with Don Shane and Bo Schembechler.
Well, certainly the most important thing to do is win, and Michigan and Michigan State did just that last Saturday, but in winning, they both showed that there is reason to be concerned about a few things. Hello, everybody. I'm Don Shane, joined as always by Bo Schembechler. Let's start with the Wolverines, a 27-7 win. If you weren't at the game like you and I were and just watching this thing on paper, you'd go, okay, that's not bad. But you, I think, have a few concerns, your biggest concerns with what Michigan looked like last Saturday against Vanderbilt.
Well, dropped passes.
Yeah.
I mean, they dropped half a dozen passes. That was troublesome. I think, too, the offensive line in terms of running the ball, they ran the ball well with their lead scheme in the first half. Mm-hmm. The second half, they sort of caught up with that and kind of shut it down a little bit. And so I'm a little bit concerned about being able to rush the football throughout a whole game.
Well, let me ask you this. We hear this all the time, that teams don't show everything in their first game that they're holding back. Did they hold back, and why wouldn't you show more to give all those other teams you're going to play something else to think about and prepare for?
Couldn't run everything that you've got in the first game, whether you held it back or not. And I would say that there were some things that I've seen in practice that I did not see on Saturday. Mm-hmm. So if you want to say that's holding it back, they held some back.
Certainly the good news is Michael Hart looked like the Michael Hart when he was a freshman.
Have to have Michael Hart at 100% full speed for them to be a good offensive team.
But the other guys behind him aren't bad. I mean, Grady's not bad. You just don't have as much confidence in them?
Well, I like Grady. I like him a lot. But he's not Michael Hart yet. And so no matter how you add it up, it's better when you have Michael in there.
Indeed it is. You know, Michigan's offense had a chance to score two or three more touchdowns. Either Henny missed an open receiver, but was talking about that, dropped passes maybe. Whatever it is, they messed up at times. And you know Lloyd was going to notice those things.
I think we had four opportunities to score touchdowns that did not take advantage of. We missed Massey down the sideline for a touchdown. We dropped a pass that was a certain touchdown, and we fumbled the football down, I think, on the 19-yard line. So we had four scores there that we did not take advantage of, and we missed a field goal. So those are things that certainly we have to do better.
All right, I know you can't fluff off those things, obviously, even though it's the first game, right? You can't say, it was the first game, we'll be all right. Or can you?
Well, I certainly worry about the kicking game because, as you say, we missed an extra point, field goal blocked, kick returns were terrible. We didn't field them very well. We didn't block for them very well. I think they got some work to do on those special teams.
Do they also have work to do defensively? Because the defense played pretty well except for one kind of trick play. Or can you not really tell against the Vanderbilt?
Little of both. I think they're an improved defensive team from a year ago. And I temper that by saying that I don't think that Vanderbilt is an explosive offensive team.
Mm-hmm. Lamar Woodley played like the player that I think we all thought he could be and would be. True?
Great player.
Yeah.
Wonderful player. I thought he played an excellent game. And the one time that he blitzed and hit that quarterback, I thought he's going to kill him. I mean, I felt sorry for that kid when he got in.
You know, Central Michigan today, they lost their opener to Boston College. They had a chance to win. It was tied late. And then they tried what they call what? The swinging gate or something
swinging
like that?
Gate.
All right. Let's look at that play. And it's a crazy, right. It's kind of a chancy thing to run, I guess. But it didn't work because the quarterback threw an interception.
Yes. Well, I can tell you for a fact that is not what those coaches had in mind when they set that play up for that quarterback to run to the sideline, jump in the air, throw the ball down there where there are half a dozen guys. Somebody's going to pick it off.
Well, I mean, he could have run. He had guys in front of him he could have thrown it to, or he could have thrown it out of bounds. Didn't do any one of those things. Did, like, the worst thing he could have done, right?
The absolute worst thing he could do, he did.
He does anything like that today against Michigan, that's, you can forget it.
Michigan would be very happy if he did. I don't think he will.
Yeah, I don't either. Bo and I are just getting started. When we come back, We will talk about Eastern Michigan. They lost to Ball State in their opener, now have to travel to East Lansing to play the Spartans. A former Michigan quarterback who played under Bo is fighting for his life. How you might be able to help Tom Slade in his battle with cancer. And you'll meet a guy you probably haven't heard a lot about until now and could have a very special year. That and more when Bo and I come back with more of the tickets. So please, stay with us.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket is brought to you in part by the University of Michigan Health System. Working together, that's the Michigan difference.
And welcome back to the Big Ten Ticket. Eastern plays at MSU today. They lost last week to Ball State. They lost last year at Michigan, you might remember. And as Tom Lydon tells us, despite all that, they are confident they can pull off a big upset today.
Eastern Michigan knows shockwaves will reverberate around the country if they knock off MSU. But truthfully, they're just looking for a better performance than they showed last year against Michigan.
For some reason, we just didn't keep our poise and made a lot of just self-inflicted wounds, and that's going to always turn out to a bad outcome. A lot of these young men, you know, received calls, received letters from the Big Ten programs, and first of all, they all feel like, you know, they got overlooked, and so they got a little chip on their shoulder going into a Big Ten stadium.
In last week's loss to Ball State, quarterback Tyler Jones emerged as a weapon not only throwing, but also running the ball.
It just gave me confidence for this game. I mean, I do have the ability to pass the ball, so I'm going to show everyone this game that I can pass the ball.
While Tyler Jones' impressive performance may have taken the Spartans by surprise when they saw it on tape, they could not have been shocked by what they saw from Eric Delorier. The fifth-year wideout once again proved he is a legitimate NFL prospect, hauling in 10 passes for 127 yards and a touchdown.
I was recruited as a quarterback. I just wanted to play. When the coaching staff said, do you want to play receiver, I said, you know, I just want to get on the field. Staying at it, working on my steps, working on my hands, jug machines, of course working with the quarterbacks, and just trusting people around me.
It's great to look out there and see that big, tall, white guy out there. I mean, it's fun. I love it.
Expecting a win may be a bit much, but expecting the Eagles to gain some respect and also earn some recruiting muscle seems to be a reasonable request. With the Eagles in Ypsilanti, this is Tom Lydon for the Big Ten Ticket.
All right, the big question is, does Eastern have any chance at all in this game today?
Anytime you tee the ball up.
Yeah.
One team has 11 playing at all times. The other team has 11 playing at all times. Anything can happen.
But
the chances of it happening are not good for Eastern Michigan.
Do teams like Eastern and Central playing at Michigan schedule these games purely for a payday?
Yes. Well, yes.
Why did you hesitate?
Well, because it's a great thrill for the Eastern team to go into Spartan Stadium, take on the big guys. They like to do that. The problem is that those people have to be careful they don't do it too often. Because if they do, if they play two or three of those teams before they get into the regular conference schedule, they're never going to make it.
But the coaches and the kids have to believe going in they have a chance, do they not, despite
yes,
the odds?
Absolutely.
So they go in thinking they can win no matter what?
Yes, and that usually lasts the first quarter.
Michigan State clearly struggled some last week against Idaho. They won the game, but quarterback Drew Stanton and head coach John L. Smith not happy with the way they played.
I thought overall as a football team we were tentative. We didn't come off and play with abandon. It was just more tentative than anything. We didn't have to play with a better attitude, more abandon, more sure of ourselves, more confidence than we did. So those are things we're going to work on.
We can't expect that kind of effort and that kind of output in order, you know, to be successful and be where we want to be. You know, Eastern Michigan is going to come in here and they're going to be ready to play it. And, you know, we have to continually get better each week. And, you know, Pittsburgh just, you know, did a real good job with Virginia and then obviously Notre Dame. So, you know, I don't think it extends to the Big Ten. It's our entire schedule. You know, anybody on there is capable of beating us if we don't come out and play with an abandonment that we need to.
You know, we've talked about the little guys, what they get out of the game. What does State get out of this? What does Michigan get out of Central other than they're beating up on somebody and running up a score?
Well, you know...
I mean, does it really prepare you to play a Big Ten team?
You'd rather play a tougher schedule before you get into some of the bigger games. You take, for example, Notre Dame in the third game will play Michigan. Notre Dame is going to play against Georgia Tech and Penn State. That's a lot tougher than Vanderbilt and Central Michigan.
You bet.
And in my judgment, that's great advantage to Notre Dame.
Especially if you win those games, huh?
Yeah.
Wow, you've beaten two really good teams, and they've already beaten Georgia Tech.
That's right.
You know, there's some history with MAC teams beating Big Ten teams. We will relive that with you, and Bo will talk about one of his former players who is putting up a courageous battle against cancer. That and more when the Big Ten Ticket continues, so please stay with us.
This is the 2007...
You know, there is history for a MAC team to beat a Big Ten team. CMU beat MSU in 91 and 92 at Spartan Stadium. In 91, it was 20-3. It's called the greatest win in CMU history. In 92, Joe Youngblood threw two touchdown passes. Brian Pruitt scored the game-winning touchdown late. Chips took care of Michigan State 24-20. As for Michigan and Central, Michigan has won both games between those two schools. Now, with that as a backdrop, it's easy to overlook certain teams. You're talking about 18 to 22-year-old kids who are big favorites like the Michigan kids to beat the Chips today and play Notre Dame next Saturday. Is there a danger of overlooking Central at all?
If you saw the Boston College game, you know that Central's a dangerous team. Their defense is a bunch of tough, strong guys. They swarm around the ball, and they have a motor. So this is not going to be an easy, you know, pushover. We need to put all of our energy into Central, and I think we're going to do that. It's going to be easy not to overlook them because, I mean, they're a good team.
They're going to be a team that's going to come in and play hard. That's one thing I do know about them, and I know they're going to be an offense that's going to try to score points like everybody do. So we got to go out there with the same mentality of trying to stop whatever they're trying to do and come out with a victory.
All right, well, they are well-schooled, certainly in the Lloyd Carr, Bo Schembechler mode to say what they actually should be saying about this game. But players can say they won't overlook somebody, especially with a Notre Dame coming up. But coaches always worry about it anyway, don't they?
Yes, they do. And and there isn't any question about that. That is your biggest worry going into this game.
But it's human nature. These are young kids. To look at, you know, who they're playing, to see the point spreads, we're going to win this game.
That's right.
How do you stop that?
Well, luckily against Boston College, Central Michigan came very close and looked good. So it isn't like they're a team that just got blown out the week before. That's not true. So that helped a little. But it's still, I'm not going to try to deceive you. It's they look at a Mid-American team, and let's face it, Michigan has never lost to a Mid-American team.
Right.
So that would be an unprecedented upset.
Yeah, we don't think that's going to happen. Now, I'm sure Michigan fans remember Tom Slade. He's a former Michigan quarterback from the early 70s. Well, Tom is battling cancer, and a bone marrow transplant is one of the options that could save his life. Right now, he says he's feeling okay and looking optimistically toward the future.
I'm very hopeful for my own prognosis. Whether it be a bone marrow transplant or some other medicine that evolves in the time that I'm healthy. Right now, I'm very healthy because of a stem cell transplant, and it's made these last few months just wonderful for me. I am living very close to how I used to live. You know, I still have to go to the doctor every other week. I still have to do the tests and do everything else, but my quality of life at this exact moment in time is very good, and I'm grateful.
Tom felt well enough to go to the Michigan opener last Saturday against Vanderbilt. He calls the games therapeutic. And he's so very thankful that Lloyd Carr and the entire Michigan family continue to help him personally and with the Red Cross Run Blood and Bone Marrow Drive held last Sunday.
It's got my name on it, and it's, yes, I'd love to find a match. I mean, that's my goal. But in all reality, what we're really doing is we're putting a lot of people into the system that could help a whole lot of people, not just me.
That's typical of Tom, so unselfish, so caring about others. And he has made sure to tell us about one other person who was there for him when he needed it most.
When I got sick, real sick, about, 8 or 10 months ago, they told most people that I would not survive that episode. And when I finally woke up from the whole deal, they had restricted my room, no visitors, no anything, except one guy had pushed his way into my room And when I woke up, the first person I saw sitting at the end of my bed was Bo Schembechler.
Now, I know this is difficult for you because you've been coaching for 21 years and over 2,000 kids, and in many ways, yeah, you're like a father figure. This is tough for you, isn't it?
Yeah, it's tough. It's not the first time I faced situations like this with some of my players. But Tom, when I heard about his situation and the thought I was going to lose him within a week, I was in Florida. I came home so I could see him. And he was sleeping there in bed. I thought he would never wake up. And I was sitting down at the end of the bed. I just leaned back and said, I'm going to stay here until he wakes up. And he woke up, and we had a little conversation. It's been unbelievable since I first saw him. The improvement in just the way he acts, everything about him, he feels better. He's doing a tremendous job. When I first saw him, he had these chemo treatments and just, you know, he felt awful. But he's one tough son of a gun. He's convinced me, anyway, that he's going to make it.
Yeah, I mean, people don't know you the way I do, and, you know, you come off for years as this pretty gruff guy, but you've got some tears in your eyes, and it's an emotional thing. And you feel responsibility for a lot of these kids who you dealt with for so many years. You go to weddings and birthdays and funerals and everything still.
Yeah, well, Tom's parents are gone now, and so I'm kind of stepping in there acting as dad. So that's what I'm doing.
Doing a good job of it.
Hey.
You're welcome. One more segment to go. In a moment, you'll hear from defensive lineman Rondell Biggs. And a very nice young man giving youngsters who, I don't know, he has turned into a heck of a football player. That story and more when we come back. Please don't go away. Every week, Bo and I select a player of the game sponsored by Michigan Healthcare System. And this week, it is Michigan defensive lineman Rondell Biggs. He caused havoc for Vandy on Saturday in the backfield a lot with sacks and tackles for losses and really disrupting play a lot. And when he is healthy, he is a terrific player. Rondell Biggs is our player of the game. Not a lot of people know much about Rondell, but he's a fifth-year senior out of Southfield Lathrop High School who might not even be playing college football if he hadn't changed his mind about playing in high school.
Started my ninth grade year in high school. Then I actually quit my 10th grade year because we went 0-9. So I thought football just wasn't for me. So, yeah, and then I started back again in my 11th grade year.
Lloyd Carr is certainly glad Rondell decided to stay with the game. Biggs worked extremely hard rehabbing his knee after suffering an injury in the Michigan State game and clearly had his best game ever against Vanderbilt with 6 tackles, 4 for losses, and 2 sacks. His parents are huge supporters. They show up at every game. And how does Rondell feel about football in his career now?
Love it, man. Pays for school, you know. My mom comes to every game, man. She loves to watch the games. I can go over her house and she's up there watching football. She watches more than me almost, you know. And this is a lady who didn't know nothing about it before this. And she thinks she's a coach, actually. I don't know. She might have probably tried to convince Coach Carr to let her come in and coach. But she thinks she's a coach. She's real critical.
Rondell Biggs was one of the last guys that we signed in his recruiting class, and that's a great story because he played linebacker, and what I liked about him is that he just had a knack for getting to the football.
Certainly, kid played a nice game. You know, it's nice to have Woodley taking up a lot of guys. Not to take anything away from this young man. He took advantage of it, at
least.
Yes,
he did, and he made plays, and he looked good. And they need that inside there, and he's a good kid and a good football player.
Well, you mentioned that, good kid. He does things like he took one kid to get his suit, a freshman, because he wasn't ready, you know, for the look the right way going. He takes kids that are on the team that need to go through rehab. He takes them. I mean, he does a lot of nice things for the other guys on the team, doesn't he?
He's a good guy.
Yeah.
He's one of the really good guys.
All right, you know, we would be remiss if we didn't discuss the biggest game of the weekend.
Yeah, I think
number one and number two, Ohio. No, you didn't think Michigan and Central, did you? Ohio State.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. the biggest game for us is not necessarily the biggest game
That's
nationally.
Good. But this is a big game. Your thoughts on Ohio State and Texas?
Ohio State's offense, I think, is tremendous. They are not as good a defensive team as they were a year ago. Now, I don't think that Texas can match them offensively. Texas may be able to match them, and more so defensively. So it's going to be that kind of a battle. It'll be very close, but I'll tell you this. When you look at that Ohio State offense, it makes you nervous. There are too many skilled guys, great quarterback, great running backs. Mm-hmm. And you haven't even seen all their running backs yet, because they got something they've been hiding back in there that I'm sure they're going to spring on Texas.
Pretty rare for so a second week of the season for number one and two to be playing. That doesn't happen very often, does it?
Well, now, wait a minute. Let's get that straight.
History right coming here, boys.
Let's get that straight. Television moved Texas up to two. So they could have one against two.
The coaches did that.
No,
not
they
television.
Didn't. Who had that game? Who has that game? ABC?
I believe so, yes.
It's your outfit.
I will
and
take.
And you orchestrated one and two.
I will take full responsibility for this. I'm just glad we're seeing it. It's on our air. That's it for this week. Enjoy the doubleheader coming up here on Channel 7, Central at Michigan, Eastern at MSU. Until next week, I'm Don. He's Bo. Thanks for watching. We hope to see you next Saturday.
Channel 7's Big Ten Ticket has been brought to you by the University of Michigan Health System. Working together, that's the Michigan difference.
As they leap into a Big Ten football Saturday at the Big House, Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor. Intrastate rivals get together as the Central Michigan Chippewas pay a visit to the Michigan Wolverines. Hi, everybody. I'm Wade Larrabee along with Kelly Stauffer. Great to have you with us for this second week of college football. And as you take a look at this ballgame, Central Michigan coming off a competitive loss at home against the ACC's Boston College. Maybe that bodes well for today.
I think it really does. It gives them confidence coming into the Big House. They had a chance to win that game late after being down 31-10.
And they nearly survived an untimely change of quarterbacks very early in the ball game last week. Take a look at it. Brian Brunner, the starter, suffered a concussion on this play, the second play from scrimmage for the Chippewas. And Kelly, that brought on Dan LeFevre, who had an outstanding night.
He really did. A redshirt freshman that came in with a great deal of poise. He has a very good feel of the game. Not a tremendously strong arm, but he can make all the throws. But that's what he does best right there. He gets out of the pocket, design quarterback runs. He gives his team an opportunity to win games.
And he will start here today for the Chippewas. Speaking of quarterbacks, well, Michigan has its junior quarterback behind center, Chad Henne. He had kind of a mixed result last week.
You would think the sky is falling, but he actually had a good season last year. But right now, he has to learn how to do things consistently well. You can see those aren't very good numbers for a team that's vying for not only a national title, but a Big Ten championship. He has to do things better, but wide receivers has to get to football, and they need to protect this young man better as well.
Yeah, Michigan, much room for improvement, according to the coaches, off their victory over Vanderbilt here last week. Coming up, we'll take a look at zone blocking Michigan style when we return to Ann Arbor.
Now, today's ESPN Plus game is brought to you by Comcast, connecting you with more, and by Bell Tire. Trust us, we'll make you happy you came in. That's a promise.
A beautiful day so far at Michigan Stadium. College football Saturday, Central Michigan and the Michigan Wolverines. While a 7-5 record would be cause for celebration in most parts, it is cause for consternation here at Michigan. A bitter loss last year here at home to arch rival Ohio State and subsequent fall to Nebraska in the Alamo Bowl left the Wolverines unranked for the first time since 1984.
Coming off a 7-5 season, you got to come in there with a whole different attitude.
It's not good at all. You know, you get no respect. It's just, you know, we don't lose five games. At some schools, it can be, well, that's a good year. But not in Michigan. A lot of people say Michigan, you know, they're not as good as they used to be. They're falling, you know, falling off the block. And I think we can make, you know, a lot of noise this year if we do everything right, if we continue to work hard and just get better as a team.
You always gonna stress the negative when you come out 7-5, but you also gotta stretch the positive. I mean, we got a lot of guys coming back, a lot of guys who got game experience, so that's something to look forward to.
It's definitely not what Michigan is about. You know, we're about winning seasons and winning championships, and definitely last year is not what we wanted, and it gives us, I think, motivation for this upcoming year that we don't want that to happen again. It'll make us work harder.
Well, part of the reason for the 7-5 Michigan record a season ago, Kelly Stauffer, was injuries. But the other part was the ground game. The usually potent Michigan ground game had slumped to ninth overall to the Big Ten, so changes in the offing.
Really, they couldn't run the ball at opportune times. They needed to close out games, and they weren't very effective at doing that last year. So it's a re-emphasis on running the football this year.
Let's take a look at the blocking scheme last year first. Tell us about it.
Well, last year it was the gap blocking or man-to-man blocking. It's basically overpower the guy in front of you, and Michigan in years past has been able to consistently do that. That is starting to change because there's more parity. Everyone's big in the weight room, and Michigan just can't line up and consistently knock people off the ball.
And this year they install a zone blocking scheme.
Yeah, and the zone blocking scheme is a little bit more finesse and athletic linemen up front moving in unison, flexibility by the running back. Everyone is dancing to the right in this case together, and then the running back with vision has the opportunity to burst through any expanded running lane that he sees.
And as you look at last week, dividends paid. Over 200 yards rushing for Michigan in the win over Vanderbilt. The Comcast keys to the game for today against Central Michigan. Let's take a look at it.
Well, Central Michigan has to win on the perimeter. They have to prove that their skilled players outside, wide receivers in particular, can get it done, and they have to control the line of scrimmage. Head coach Brian Kelly believes that they're physical enough to do that. Michigan has to get much sharper in the passing game. It starts with quarterbacks, receivers, and also pass protection. And then Michigan has to take any hope from the Central Michigan team right off the top.
The keys brought to you by Comcast. Comcast, connecting you with more. Stay tuned. The kickoff coming up from Michigan Stadium shortly. Welcome back to Michigan Stadium. Another sellout crowd on hand. Better than 100,000. 127th year of Michigan football. And how about this matchup in the trenches? Joe Staley, the left tackle of the Chippewas. Lamar Woodley, who has been at Michigan now playing on a regular basis for 4 years, came in as a much ballyhooed freshman and is ready to have his best year this season at defensive end, Kelly.
Joe Staley, a big left tackle, former tight end. He's a tremendous athlete, 4'7" in the 40, very, very strong. And Woodley right now is really coming into his own. He's healthy for the first time in a long time, and he's also learning what it takes to be great at his position. That will be tremendous as this game unfolds.
Brian Kelly, the head coach at Central Michigan in his third season, has seen quite a revival in this program over the last 2 years. And Lloyd Carr in his 12th season as head coach at Michigan. Five-time Big Ten champions. He's been here at Michigan as either an assistant or a head coach for over a quarter of a century.
Yeah, and at 7-5, you would think the big Michigan sky is falling here, wouldn't you?
Well, as you well know, I know a lot of schools that would be celebrating 7-5, but not here. Speaking of skies, we have a beautiful afternoon right now. It is clouding up just a bit. There's a chance of a shower, just a chance, but it should be just a beautiful day for college football in early September. Michigan won the toss, elected to receive. A lot of times teams will win the toss and defer their decision to the second half. But I think exactly what you said in the open, Lloyd Carr and Michigan, they want to get that offense on the field, get up on Central Michigan as quick as they can.
I think you're absolutely right on top of it. I think Michigan wants to get their offense out there, get it rolling early, and take any hope that the Chippewas have away from them right off the top.
Steve Breston back deep. Rick Albreski with the kickoff, and it will be Breston from the seven. Out across the 20-yard line, good coverage by the Chippewas. Terrence Robinson and Chris Wolgamuth, 14-yard return. Penalty marker down to the plate. Chad Henney getting set. His junior season underway last week. 26th consecutive start already. As a freshman, he led this school to the Rose Bowl. Dan Capron. Personal foul, face mask against the kicking team, the Chippewas. So
during the return, personal foul, face mask on the kicking team, number 89. That 15-yard penalty is enforced from the end of the run. First down.
So the Wolverines get it in much better field position. Joe Bockheim, the guilty party. And it's first down from the 37-yard line of Michigan for the Wolverines. Offensively, 381 yards last week against Vanderbilt. 246 on the ground, and they start with Mike Hart. Nice cutback run there. Fumble the football, recovered by Manningham. Across the 40, near the 43-yard line. Net result, a gain of 6. We take a look at the Michigan Wolverines offensively. And again, a very strong offensive line led by Jake Long, and that is a usual occurrence. The right side, they're brand new working together. And the protection somewhat shaky on that side of the line last week. The skill position players, Mike Hart, Breston, great speed, Manningham, a long receiver, and Tyler Ecker, a very good tight end. So Chad Henney has some weapons around him. Two tight ends in the ball game right now, as Carson Butler is on the wing. And Henney looks to the air with a quick throw to a wide open Manningham. First down into Central Michigan territory. Josh Gordy was giving plenty of cushion, and he gives up a 14-yard gain. The Chippewa defense up front. Daniel Bazine is everybody's first-round draft choice of the NFL next year. In the linebacking core, Ike Brown is very active. These players run well to the ball behind that front line. And then in the secondaries where they have some problems, strong safeties, but they're a little questionable on the corners. Boston College burned them last week. Mike Hart off right tackle across the 40 and down to about the 39-yard line, a gain of 3 yards. Over to make that tackle, the linebacker, Doug Press.
We've already seen a couple of very strong examples of that zone running scheme. And the Chippewas from Central Michigan, they're a very good run defense. They were number one in the MAC a year ago. But they're going to be tested every snap this game. Michigan wants to get that running game going and prove that they can do it early on.
Well, Boston College, 85 yards rushing last week, and averaged less than 3 yards per rushing attempt. Here comes Breston. Brian Kelly, first down for Michigan to the 29-yard line. Press and Gordy made the stop, gain of 9. Brian Kelly mentioned to me last evening here that what he was worried about was when Michigan gets its skill position people into space, and that's where Preston is right here.
Right, we've already seen this is the second example of it. It's quick touches by the wide receivers. Get the ball to Preston early, let him square to the line of scrimmage and go make a play. I think that's where there's a big, big discrepancy between talent is the secondary of Central Michigan and the skill position for Michigan.
First and 10. Play action, Henney under pressure. Able to get away from Bazine. Gets it away wide of the mark, intended for Hart. Boy, I tell you, they were raining down on him that time. Ogle was also there, along with Ronnie Ekdahl. So the defensive lineman came to the fore, forcing a second and 10 for Michigan.
And Wayne, you talked about it from the top. It's that right side for Michigan. Mitchell and Riley are playing together for only the second time. They started last week together. There was a lot of different lineups because of injuries last year for the Wolverines, and right now that offensive line is trying to get a feel for one another.
Second and 10. Here comes Hart. And they clog it up once again, a short gain. In on that tackle, Daniel Bezine. And one of the things they're going to do with their All-American, All-MAC defensive end, Bezine, is move him around, Kelly, trying to create the best matchup they can. So he won't be going up against Jake Long on every play. They'll move him back and forth on each side of the line.
And defensive coordinator Joe Tressi said that he came in so late. He was hired in February. He really hasn't had a chance to really design a scheme to get Bezine all over the field. Woodley does it on the opposite side for the Wolverines.
Third and seven at the Chippewa 26. Blitz coming. Penny's pass is tipped short of the mark, incomplete. Was trying to get it to the far sidelines and Adrian Arrington, but the ball tipped.
And Bezine doing the tipping, and it's about getting quick penetration. And if you can't get to the quarterback, get your hands up right there. It's the move outside, the quick swim inside, and that is what Riley is going to have a hard time with. That's a very, very tough matchup.
Looks like Michigan's going to go for it on fourth and seven at the Chippewa 26-yard line. Manningham and Adrian Arrington at the top of your screen. Preston's on the bottom. Hart the long set back, and Henny has time. Manningham, does he have enough for the first down? Depends on the spot of the ball. He's very close, just inside the 20-yard line, and apparently he does. They're going to give him yardage to the 18, where it's a first and 10. Pacino, Horn, and Red Keith on the stop, gain of 8.
And with Preston, number 15, working outside at his wide receiver position, Eckert just goes down and runs a quick out route right at the bottom of the screen. Finds the void, catch it, make sure you're running that route deep enough to pick up the first down, which he did right there.
Yeah, sometimes the receiver doesn't run it deep enough, and then he's got a face full of quarterback coming to the sidelines. First down. Hart trying to get to the outside, forced back inside. Good play made on the flank by Red Keith, and then he got some help from his friends. Gain of 2 down to the 16-yard line. Curtis cuts a safety flow to the play as well.
And Michael Hart is a very, very good fit for this zone running scheme, primarily because of his vision.
Yep.
He sees things so well, he can take advantage as his linemen are skating to one sideline or the other. Those running lanes expand, and he has to make a quick move, and he has to see it before he can do that.
Have to have vision and the burst to act on that vision, too, and he has both. Second down for Michigan. Hart following his blocking once again, jumping inside the 15, close to the 10-yard line. Keith, again, the linebacker on that stop. Bezine was in the neighborhood, along with Pacino Horn. And Michigan facing a third down.
And don't be surprised if Michigan goes back to the left side. Right now, Jake Long, 77, and Adam Krause, 57. That left guard and left tackle position are blowing the Chippewas off the line of scrimmage. They're finding success in the running game to that left side.
Third down. Mike Hart going left once again for first down yardage and more, close to the 5-yard line. Bezine and Horn. Bezine came from the opposite side. But Evan Brownie is having trouble getting penetration on the right side of the defense, left side of the offense.
You can see big 77 Jake Long moving that line of scrimmage. And when you're running left, if you're Michigan, you're not only running to your strength, which is Long and Krause, but you're also running away from Bezine on the opposite side.
Long opening drive for Michigan. First down and goal to go just inside the 5. Mike Hart, the cutback. Touchdown! Oh, they parted that defense like the Red Sea for Moses. 4-yard touchdown burst for Mike Hart.
I think Michigan came out meaning a little business today, and it's that running game that was highlighted in this first drive, mainly to the left side, but that was a great example. It started left. Hart sees it back really over top of the center and does a great job of cutting back where the softness is.
Garrett Rivas for the point after. And Michigan's opening drive. Capped by Mike Hart's 4-yard touchdown run. 63 yards, 12 plays. Michigan on top early at home. Hart's 4-yard touchdown run capping a 12-play, 63-yard opening drive that took 5 minutes and 26 seconds off the clock, and Michigan in impressive fashion motoring for a first down. And, you know, we talked, Kelly, about the zone blocking scheme employed here at Michigan now, and we saw it on that touchdown run.
Well, you get movement at the point of attack with Jake Long, number 77, beside him Krause, 57. That double team right there. And look how the right side washes everything down, and then Hart cuts right in behind it. That is that offensive line working in unison.
Twin safeties back deep. Ball bounding to the one of the up backs. Across the 20-yard line, 25, 30, 35, and out near the 38-yard line. So it'll be first and 10 from there. The up back, return that, Joe Bockheim. There is Dan Lefevre, burst on the scene last week after the starter, Brian Brunner, went out with a concussion. He's not going to play this week, and Lefevre played very well, showed good poise in that Boston College game. First and 10 for the Chippewas. They'll spread out Michigan all day. Lefevre running option for the wide receiver Anderson. Covered up by the linebacking core. Prescott Burgess playing today in place of the injured Chris Graham. Graham a late scratch due to a leg injury. Take a look at the offensive line. Joe Staley is a big-time player at left tackle. So is Drew Mormino, one of the better centers in the MAC. And the skill position players, Obed Satut is the threat downfield and wide receiver. Second down and about 7. Lefevre. Sneed took a shot from behind by Morgan Trent. And we take a look and line up the Michigan defenders for you. Lamar Woodley, a standout. So is Ryan Branch and Rondell Biggs on that line. Crable, Harris, and Burgess. Burgess can play all three linebacking positions. Leon Hall is the standout in that cornerback slot, an All-America candidate. We met Jamar Adams yesterday afternoon, and he was the most impressive young man to talk to, as well as Rondell Biggs and Mike Hart. Opening quarter, it is a first down for the Chippewas. Lefevre off play action, and he basically threw it away. Got some late pressure as Woodley was able to leak through and force the quarterback overthrow.
And Lefevre, his number one trait is supposed to be poise, and he's going to need poise in bunches here today. It's one thing to open up your career at home, but here in the big house in front of about 110,000, that young man right there is going to need poise.
Redshirt freshman from Downers Grove, Illinois. A little swing pass out to Anderson. Nice move around the corner. Got yardage into Michigan territory. Down near the 44-yard line of the Wolverines. Tackle made by Ryan Mundy. Gain of 7.
Yeah, poise is needed because all those fans are rooting for one team.
Well, you know,
and there's plenty of them.
This isn't the first time the Chippewas have played before 100,000. They did this at Penn State about a year ago. And, of course, a couple of years ago, they were here in Michigan Stadium to take down the Wolverines. It is a third down at about 3. Linson, the man in motion. Lefevre over the middle. Nice strike to Anderson. Anderson has good size at that wide receiver spot. 6'4", 206. He's an inviting target not only for a quarterback, but also for a linebacker like David Harris, who made the hit. First down.
A young quarterback in a difficult situation, being decisive. That's what it takes. 1, 2, 3, throw the football. Good decision, good first down.
No huddle offense, pass knocked away. That is the All-America candidate, Leon Hall, denying the pass completion to Obed Satut.
Ron English told us that Leon Hall has to play better today. You can see the closing ability, speed. I think that's where the big difference is in this game. The skilled players for Michigan against the skilled players for Central Michigan. You can see it right there with Hall's speed.
Central Michigan again goes without a huddle on 2nd and 10. Lefevre trying to cross up the defense. Ontario Sneed into the clear. Oh, and good blocking downfield by the wide receivers, in particular Damian Linson. And it's a first down to the 14-yard line of Michigan for the Chippewas.
The spread option offense for Central Michigan is about spreading people out and then taking advantage of the speed on the defensive side. Get them out of position by misdirection, and then Sneed is a north-south runner. He knows what to do with it when he gets the balls in his hand. And blocking downfield, receivers not only catch it, but they also have to block.
Gain of 25 to the 14 of Michigan for the Chippewas. LeFever fumbles. It's a live ball. Wolverines have it. Woodley's got it now. Crable had it initially, and it'll be Michigan football near the 50-yard line. Lamar Woodley forced the fumble and eventually made the recovery. Kelly, was it a little indecision there?
Exactly. Watch the hesitation. Right there, the ball needs to be gone. When you wait against this Wolverine defense, particularly Woodley, bad things are going to happen. The redshirt freshman didn't quite sort out what he saw downfield. Throw the ball out of bounds. Live to play another day.
First down, Michigan, 49-yard line of the Wolverines. Hart cutting it back. Pickup of about 3 to the 48. Central Michigan had 2 turnovers in the game against Boston College, but last year they were just about airtight. Only 10 turnovers, fewest in Division 1A.
And that's how Brian Kelly has built the foundation here at Central Michigan. We win games by playing clean. Spread people out, do all those things, but in the end, hang on to the football.
3 receivers set for Michigan. And he may be changing the play of the line. Good protection, dumps it over the middle. Mike Hart is collared on a high tackled attempt by Doug Kress, the senior of Lampier, Michigan.
Chad Henney changed the play at the line of scrimmage. Actually wanted to go outside and didn't get the coverage he wanted, but a very good decision. Nothing was downfield. It's okay to check it down to a guy like Hart and let him try to get some yards after the catch.
I believe I said Lampier. It's Lapeer, Michigan, where Doug Kress is from. Third down for the Wolverines. Third and about 2. Grady trying to get to the outside, trying to push the pile. He won't push it far enough. No gain, and it's fourth down, Michigan. Kress and Keith collaborate on the stop as they tried once again to go behind Jake Long.
Are you still sending a message here to your offense? You need to get it done. It was third and, or it's fourth and 7 down in the plus territory before, and Lloyd Carr went for it. I don't think he's going to do it right here.
Nope, you're going to send out the punting team.
Just because you want to make a point to your offense doesn't mean you want to lose your head.
Although this is the part of the field where you might try a fake.
Good point.
Ross Ryan is the quote-unquote placement punter, or hang time punter. They will also use Zoltan Mesko, who has a big leg. Single safety back deep. Good height into this kick. Fair catch signal made early, and the catch completed by Damian Linson at the 17-yard line. Michigan still leads by 7, first quarter. Welcome back to Michigan Stadium. Wayne Larrabee, Kelly Stauffer, great to have you with us. Intrastate rivals Central Michigan and Michigan. First down for the Chippewas. Sneed trying to get to the outside. Brandon Engelman would have none of it. Loss of a yard or 2. Make it a loss of 3.
Wayne, what we'll see throughout the day is Central Michigan's running game is really 3 parts. It's the running back that you just saw, Sneed, on that play, but it's also wide receivers and quarterbacks. They spread the ball around under this spread option offense, give the defense a variety of looks.
That's Sneed in motion behind the quarterback. Off the hands of Damian Linson, and boy, he had the angle on the slant. Third and long coming up for the Chippewas. Leon Hall, they went into his neighborhood.
It's not really a neighborhood you want to consistently try to make a living in. And the Chippewas right here have to be very careful. Redshirt freshman playing in the big house in front of 109,000. Deep in your own territory. Don't make a mistake.
They empty the backfield. Lefevre. They try to set up a screen to Sneed. Well played by the Wolverines. Engelman, Harris, all over that play, along with Jamar Adams. And it's fourth down for Central Michigan.
Well, the good news, Central Michigan's defense held serve on that turnover. Didn't allow Michigan to get in the end zone or get any kind of points. But the bad news is the offense did nothing with to try to create some more field position.
Preston back deep. Tony Mikulich on in punt formation. The MAC West Division Special Teams Player of the Week. Mikulich just did get that line drive kick away. Bounding across the 50, here's Preston off the big hop. Slips one defender. Nice cutback into Chippewa territory to the 42-yard line of Central Michigan. 44-yard punt, 14-yard return. Michigan in plus territory to start its next drive when we come back. Welcome back to Michigan Stadium. Play suspended here at 12:30 in the afternoon. We're going to step away for a report on Penn State Notre Dame. Let's go to Mike Hall.
Hey, wow.
Welcome back to Michigan. Thank you very much, fellas. Play suspended. Skies are clearing here. It looks like that storm of the front has moved right across the stadium. This is the first weather delay in 79 years. Matter of fact, to be honest with you, the Michigan people told us it's never happened here before. So this is a first. I guess consider yourself lucky, Kelly, at your first broadcast like in the big house. But play suspended at 12:30 local time this afternoon. 3:30 to go first quarter. Michigan leading 7-0. Penn State Notre Dame coming up a little bit later on today. And I tell you, another one of those great September games. We're going to see number one against number two tonight down in Austin. But not too far from here at Notre Dame Stadium, Penn State going in to take on the Fighting Irish. That should be quite a ball game as well.
Well, Penn State has certainly some questions that they have to answer. Levi Brown, the only starting offensive lineman coming back. Morelli, the new quarterback, going into a very, very difficult place to play. Notre Dame wasn't real impressive as far as I'm concerned last week. I think Penn State has an opportunity to go in there and make a statement.
Well, you know, I think we'll find out a lot about Penn State, Kelly. Everybody's talking about Ohio State and maybe Michigan challenging Ohio State for the Big Ten title. And there is Penn State, the defending champions. And no one's given them, talked a lot about them. But that great freshman class of last year is now a sophomore class. And I would think they're going to be a potent team. We'll find out how potent maybe today against Notre Dame.
You know, I think potent, they're potent at the wide receiver position. They have speed probably five guys deep. Those young players that can get down the field, stretch things in a hurry. But my concern is this. I have a hard time throwing my head into a ring with a team that loses four out of five starting offensive linemen and then a ton on the defensive side of the ball. Now, granted, the guys that they bring back, Paul Pelusny, the linebacker, and you know, they bring back some very, very talented players, but when you lose that much on the defensive side, defense wins championships.
And on offense, you mentioned the changes on that offensive line, and that's going to impact how effective the skill position players can be, obviously. The top 25, we spoke earlier about Ohio State and Texas, USC right there, Notre Dame, and then Auburn with West Virginia, Florida, LSU, Florida State, and Michigan. Florida State with a marvelous win down to the Orange Bowl over Miami earlier this week. Tennessee, a nice win against California. Good California team that'll play Minnesota tonight out of Cal. Iowa is a team that debuted in fine fashion, playing later today up at Syracuse. And then you wind down that top 20, Penn State coming in at number 19. And 21 through 25, Nebraska, California drops to 22, then TCU, Texas Tech, and Arizona State. For our affiliate stations, this is a 30-second warning, we will be going back to break number one in about 30 seconds. Again, there is a weather delay here at Michigan Stadium. It appears, and I'm no weatherman, I don't even play a weatherman on TV, but it appears the front has moved off. Skies are brightening a little bit here at Michigan Stadium. The rain has subsided, and hopefully we'll be able to play football soon. However, by NCAA rule, we cannot start this game until at least 30 minutes after the game has been stopped. Michigan 7, Central Michigan nothing, 3:30 to go. We're going to send you back to break number one. Welcome back to Michigan. Wolverines leading 7-0, something that's never happened in the history of Michigan Stadium. We've had a weather suspension here, and skies are clearing, and we're joined by former Michigan head coach Gary Mulder. That brightened skies a little bit. Good to see you, Coach.
Well, thank you, Wayne. Good to see you.
Tell us a little bit about what you're up to now. I know after you left Michigan, you did some work with the Detroit Lions as assistant coach there in Cincinnati Bengals, I believe, right, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. What are you up to now?
And then I ended up with the Bears, and I'm back in Ann Arbor. I live north of town here. Little semi-retired, do a little PR work, but that's about it.
Well, tell us, obviously you follow this Michigan program. You know, Lloyd Carr was one of your proteges, right. and talk a little bit about what you see in Michigan this year.
Well, Lloyd worked for me at Illinois, and then later he joined us at Michigan, and I think they're going to have a good football team. I think they're healthier than they ever have been. Long's got to stay healthy. That really helps them. And Kid Hart is a very good back. So I just think as they develop their passing game, which they will, they're going to have a good football team. And they always want to get better towards the end.
You know, the thing about Michigan this year, one of the stories going in, and we documented a little bit in the pregame show, and Michigan has always been able to run the football. I don't care what season you talk about, they've always been able to run the football. But last year, they struggled in that regard. Fell to an ninth in the Big Ten. That was uncustomary for them to be ninth in the Big Ten of rushing. Put it in the new zone blocking scheme. What are your impressions of the running game based on what you've seen so far this year?
Well, I think it's improved, and some of it is new to the opponent because they do it over and over, and that's how you get good at it. Last year, I think the Hart being hurt really, I think, took a lot away. They had different backs they used in there, and I think all the backs are good ones, okay? Then they lost a couple linemen. But then they got behind in some games you were forced to throw. And so statistically, sometimes it doesn't even always point out the truth and things. But they're going to get that squared away.
You know, the other thing about it, as you take a look at it, and we're talking with Gary Mulder, the former head coach here at Michigan. Gary, Michigan's had some great skill position people, and it's hard not to throw the football to those people, especially when you have some of the quarterbacks they've had here in recent years.
Oh, exactly. Yeah, exactly. When you go through Tom Brady, yep, Navarre, and all those guys, you have to do. In fact, I had a couple good ones in Collins and Elvis Gerbach. But they do have great skill people. You have to spread it around. But the good news about it is because of those people out there, it makes your running game a little bit better, too, because you keep that, you know, what everybody indicates, the eighth guy in the box and the strong safeties down.
Now, your son is coaching, right?
Right. He coaches the offensive line here, so that's always fun to watch, too. I get to critique him and talk to him about things.
All right. Gary, thank you so much. It's wonderful to see you again. All the best.
Okay, Wayne. Thank you.
Gary Mulder, former head coach of the University of Michigan. Stay tuned. We're in a weather delay. We'll be back. We're going to break number two for our affiliate stations. We'll be back after these messages. Well, as you can see, much of the crowd has filed back into Michigan Stadium, still under a weather delay. Play was suspended at 12:30 this afternoon local time, and 3:30 to go first quarter. Michigan will have possession when we come back. It appears that we will, and again, just a weather delay, and hopefully we'll be back playing in a few moments. But another Michigan luminary is joining us, Jamie Morris, the bright smile on the face of Jamie Morris, former all-time leading rusher of Michigan football history. Jamie, working for the university now, thank you for taking time out.
No, thank you, and this is the first at Michigan, and I'm not taking responsible for this.
Yeah, this is not your area, right? You're in development right now.
I am, and I'm a fundraiser, but this is not good fundraising weather.
Well, I'm not a weatherman, but I was asked to play one on TV earlier today. But at any rate, Jamie, talk a little bit about your Michigan career. I mean, you played with some great teams back in the late 80s, this has to be just a tremendous environment to play in.
Oh, it's an incredible environment. And, you know, growing up as a kid on the East Coast of Massachusetts, you get a chance to see maybe one Michigan game, but I fell in love with those helmets and the pageantry that goes on with at Michigan. So when I got an opportunity to come out here on my recruiting trip, you know, a chance to touch the winged helmet and to be introduced to Bo Schembechler, I was done. You knew I was coming here. So.
And you are a Wolverine through and through now, right?
Oh, yeah, all the way through. And, you know, the team's doing great now. You know, we had some bad things happen last year. Things didn't go our way. But you know what? We're coming back. We're going to sneak up on some people, I think.
We've been here the last 2 days. Everybody talking about 75. 75 is 7-5 record. You know, there are a lot of schools that would celebrate 7-5, but not Michigan.
No. We have higher expectations. And when we don't achieve those, we get hungry. And I think the word around here is we're hungry.
Jamie, I was talking to your former coach, Gary Mulder. You know, everybody talked about the injuries last year, and that was a big part of Michigan's 7-5 record, but also the inability to run the football effectively. Michigan has always been able to run the football regardless of who's trying to run it. But last year, ninth in the Big Ten in rushing, and so the new zone blocking scheme now. You've seen it for almost five quarters. What are your impressions?
I'm very impressed with it, and it helps the backs choose the hole. Well, when I came to Michigan, we could run the ball, like you said. That's the staple of a Michigan football team. So, you know, you can pick and choose where you want to go. And for the backs now, the kind of backs we have here, the little squatty, short, squatty ones, like myself, you know, we get to choose and go where they want to go. So, you know, I think the zone blocking scheme is great for our offense right now.
I don't think Mike Hart would like that characterization.
Short, squatty? Oh, come on. You know, he hides behind the lineman just like me. So
yeah, whatever. You did a great job rushing for over 4,000 yards hiding behind linemen here in Michigan.
Well, it was the offensive line. I'll tell you that. We had great offensive linemen here, and, you know, that's a tradition here, too, and we need to continue that.
You know, we were talking about it earlier this weekend, and that, you know, it's not as easy, though, with the parity in college football. And you these MAC schools today, they come in with offensive lines as big as Michigan's offensive line in some cases. That, I guess, the new zone scheme helps you, you know, you're not able to blow people off the ball the way you used to.
No, you can't. I mean, everybody's got players out there now. So you just got its zone scheme, wherever they take them, where they're going, right, and cut back.
Absolutely. Well, Jamie, you were a great cutback runner in your day. All the best. Good to see you again.
Thank you very much.
Jamie Morris, one of the all-time leading rushers in Michigan history. We're under a weather delay. Hopefully, we'll be playing football soon. We'll be back after these messages.
Call your local cable provider today.
Thank you very much, Mike. Back at Michigan, we have been told it'll be at least 40 minutes before play resumes here at Michigan Stadium. We are under a weather delay. About 12:30 this afternoon, this game was halted. There was lightning in the area, or lightning strike within 5 miles of the stadium. By NCAA rule, lightning strike within 6 miles of the stadium, and the field must be cleared. But anyway, latest we hear, maybe 40 minutes before we start play once again. We've been talking about Ohio State, Texas, the big game coming up tonight. And there's a look at some of the numbers. Kelly, this should be, again, it was a great matchup last September when they met it in Columbus.
Yeah, the cast has changed to some degree. Obviously, Vince Young, among others, aren't there anymore. And now it's Troy Smith that's the playmaking veteran quarterback coming back to lead his team into a very tough place to play in Austin, Texas. But I think the question is, can Texas, with a young quarterback in McCoy, get to that secondary at Ohio State that has some question marks? Remember, there are 9 new starters on the defensive side of the ball for the number one team in the nation. Yeah. That's almost unheard of, but that shows you the explosiveness on the offensive side for Ohio State.
Well, what you're wondering about with Ohio State, and Kelly, we were at the Big Ten meetings this summer, and the thing that I looked at was, you know, on the one hand, you have Ohio State with 8 players drafted off that defense into the NFL last year, and you mentioned 9 new starters on defense, and you wonder, everyone is assuming that they just reloaded, and in fact they probably have, with very good talent, but it's an experienced talent, and that's a big question mark.
Yeah, a big question mark. If this big game came later in the season, that question mark would be a whole lot smaller, I believe, because those 9 new starters would have a few games under their belt. It's one thing to be watching from the sidelines and watching film and getting on the grease board in the coach's room, but when you're the guy on the field, things change dramatically, and they still have some question marks. Right now they're answering it positively. This will be the first true big test this season.
Northern Illinois, a good team out of the MAC, but Ohio State playing at home on the opening weekend had much too much firepower offensively, and that's really what they're banking on right now, the Ted Ginn factor and And, of course, Smith, a quarterback, and they have been just a very potent offense. And probably the offense will have to carry that program through the first months of the season. But I guarantee if they have the talent defensively, they'll be ready to go by November.
Yeah, and I think Ginn really became a wide receiver the last three or four games of last season, and then in the bowl win against Notre Dame. That's when Ginn really started to become not just the playmaker, but a wide receiver running good routes, being dependable, catching the ball. We know what he can do with the football after he gets it in his hands, but now he's a true wide receiver. They have Smith making good decisions. You know, they have a veteran group up front, probably the best offensive line. Maybe, I guess you could debate that with Iowa in the Big Ten. But I tell you what, on the offensive side of the ball, there aren't many question marks.
Kelly, you know, we've seen a lot of big games in September, and this is kind of unusual. And a lot of it is created by television matchups, prime time, et cetera, et cetera. But there are some difficult schedules being played in the early going. Michigan will play Notre Dame next week. We mentioned the tough games today. Penn State at Notre Dame. Notre Dame played last week down at Georgia Tech. Florida, Tennessee coming up. LSU, Auburn. A lot of tough games early. Are you of the mind that you can't win a national championship in September, but you sure can lose one? And there's a lot of risk going on in college football across the country this first month of the season.
Yeah, you said that yesterday about you can lose a national championship in September, and I think that's truer than ever. You know, with the 12 games, you really have to use your imagination to try to fill your schedule. You know your conference schedule is coming down the road, and now you're starting to get some heavy hitters coming in early in the season. Yeah, and I think there's a lot to be said, and I think that also speaks to the importance of where you're ranked early in the season, because you can absorb a loss early if you're ranked high enough. You can still climb back in it. But if you're starting, you know, down there in the teens or 20s in terms of ranking, it's hard to take a loss early and then rebound from that in the name of the national picture.
But if you're thinking national picture, generally you're not playing three cupcakes in September before a conference season. You're playing someone of import at least once in that non-conference schedule, it seems like, and getting you ready for the conference schedule. And it'll be interesting to see the parity in college football we talked about. And yes, the sisters are here, and hopefully they're praying for this rain to pass.
Hopefully it's working.
But anyway, 3:30 to go. We're in a weather delay at the Big House, Michigan Stadium. Michigan leading 7-0. We'll be back. Oh, those kids haven't left. They've been here all day. They did not leave for the rain delay. They stayed right in their seats, and they're ready to go. And hopefully we'll have the Wolverines and the Chippewas ready to go in short order. We are in a rain delay. Started about 12:30. We have at least 30 more minutes before the two teams will be back on the field. That's if all things go well and this front moves through here. But that's the story here at Michigan Stadium, with the Wolverines leading Central Michigan 7-0. It's a pleasure to have alongside the legendary head coach of the Michigan Wolverines, Mr. Bo Schembechler. Bo, great to see you.
Well, nice to be here, Wayne. This is the first time I've ever had a circumstance like this, where we had a rain delay and you had to go back into the locker room.
This would never happen on your watch, right?
Well, it happened, and they say that. But somebody asked me, he said, well, what are they telling them in there? What are they doing in there? I said, I don't know. They're playing cards or doing something.
Well, you know, obviously, at safety purposes, lightning in the area, you've got to get the kids off the field and that type of thing. But, you know, interesting, as a coach, that is an interesting point. You got your players lathered up. They're in the middle of the first quarter of the ball game. They're ready to go. And now you blow everybody off the field in for a half hour, 45 minutes or more. Everybody kind of cools out. Bo, that's a little concerning too, isn't it?
It is. But they played almost a quarter, which means that they know a lot about what the game's going to go, how it's going to go, what kind of defenses they're going to meet, what kind of offense, what they're trying to do. They have a lot of things to talk to these kids about that can take up a lot of that time. But the big thing they have to do is when they come back out here after playing and then coming back, they got to warm up all over again. Because if they don't, they're going to get hamstring pull or something like that.
Well, that is a concern for the players. You definitely have to get them off the field in lightning, but when they do come back after maybe an hour or more of being out, it's somewhat hard to rev it up, I would imagine, once again. It takes time.
All right, well, of course, I'm not used to it. I don't recall, I really don't recall ever having been involved in one of these. I've been involved in rain delay, but that's only 10, 15 minutes. Sure. I've never been involved with one this long.
Bo, let's talk a little bit about what you see in Michigan this year. What are your impressions of the early going?
Well, I think they've improved some defensively from last year. I think we can say that. I think offensively, I would still be concerned about their running game. I don't think it's consistent enough. They'll break a play now and then, but it's not quite consistent enough. So they got to run the ball a little better. And if they play defense, like they've been playing, I think they'll be all right. But there's one thing that's always sticks in the back of my mind is that our next game is against Notre Dame. Notre Dame's playing Georgia Tech and Penn State, and we're playing Vanderbilt and Central Michigan. I wonder whether that really gets us ready for a team like Notre Dame.
I got to ask you, though, also in college football, Bo, we're seeing a lot of big games in the month of September. There's a lot of risk going on here, isn't
right.
it?
Well, yeah, but, when you go to 12 games, you got to start scheduling. I had hoped that the Big Ten would have gone to a 9-game schedule. A 9-game schedule, we wouldn't have as many co-championships. Right. And you play 9 conference games, 3 non-conference, and we would then pick a 2 champion, and I think it would be a better schedule for us. But the coaches, you know, they'd like to play Allegheny A&M if they can to add a victory so they could go to a bowl game. And I always resented that a little bit.
Well, and, you know, also, though, the big games in September are TV-driven. I mean, a lot of these matchups we're seeing.
Oh, geez, yeah. Texas, Ohio State, they don't get any bigger than that. Yeah. Penn State and Notre Dame, that's a big game. And next week we'll be going to South Bend. That's a big game. There's a lot of big games early. But there's so much parity in college football that when the number one team in the country plays the 25th, that's a big game.
Yeah. Oh, no question about it. Yeah. And you're right. And, you know, you take a look at what's going on around college football. These MAC schools are a heck of a lot more potent ability-wise today than they were back in your day.
Well, look at this team. Now, I can't tell you, you know this guy's name and plays defense for Central Michigan. What's his name?
Bazine.
First thing I looked at on the opening play is where is Bazine going to line up? And sure enough, they moved him away from Long, our left tackle, to the right side over there. And the son of a gun is in on almost every play, isn't he?
He sure is.
The guy could play football anywhere.
Sure.
And so Central Michigan has some outstanding players and a pretty good team. Just like Vanderbilt wasn't bad. I mean, it was a decent test. So there's a lot of parity in college football.
Well, Bo, it's always great to see you. Why don't you hold up your 2-iron here and see if you can clear out some of this rain. Not even God could hit a 2-iron, according to Lee Trevino.
I can't hit one that far. I'd have to use the driver.
Bo, great to see you once again.
Thank
you, Wayne. All right.
Good luck to you the rest of the season.
You bet. Thank you. Bo Schembechler, the legendary head coach of the Michigan Wolverines. We're in a weather delay at Michigan Stadium, and hopefully we'll be playing football shortly. We'll be back after these messages. Well, the Wolverine fans hanging in there through this weather delay. It's been about 30 minutes since the last lightning strike in the area. And so we should start seeing some activity stirring on the field soon. But the kids have had a good time through it all. Let's go back to Central Michigan's game last week. I mentioned in the open of the program today a very competitive loss to Boston College at home, but some ill-timed play calls in the game. Second quarter, this is a 4th-and-8 on the 25-yard line of Central Michigan, and they go for it here, and the pass deflected short of the mark, incomplete. That gave Boston College great field position to move in. in the fourth quarter. A minute 40 to go on the clock. This is as strange a setup as you'll see, Kelly.
Yeah, the old swinging gate. And, no, that was for the tying or possibly go-ahead points right there in that game. They had come back from 31 to 10 and had an opportunity to tie that game and go into overtime or go for two and win it. And I just don't quite understand, especially the first one. You know, it was fourth and eight. You know, your team is holding their own against BC. And what Brian Kelly said to us, the head coach of Central Michigan, he said that, you know, that's part of how he rolls, what he likes to do. However, in hindsight, it was about, you know, the play calling with a redshirt quarterback in the game. You know, he didn't feel that he had the right people to execute the things that he asked him to execute. And in the end, he concluded he put his team behind the eight ball.
Yeah, he said ill-timed on some of those play calls. And he mentioned on that play call in the second quarter, fourth and eight on their own 25, he said that, well, really what we had with Lefebvre there was a pass or punt option, gooch punt option, but it didn't look like Lefebvre had any option in his mind whatsoever. He was going to throw the pass.
You know, very decisive. And I think on your own 25 that early in the game, you don't give a redshirt freshman quarterback any options.
Yes, any options at all in that situation. Well, some of the players are coming back onto the field, and hopefully we'll be playing football very shortly. But you see some of the cheerleaders coming back. A couple of the players are on the field as well. And as Bo Schembechler mentioned a few moments ago, Kelly, this will take some, it's going to take, it's very important that these guys get loose again. They prepared pre-game, got loose, all the exercise, everything they do, they were ready to go. They're in the middle heat of the battle, so to speak. Then they shut everything down and basically, as we would say, dry out. Well, you know, now they've got to warm up and lather up again. And this is something, this part of it is very important, because you can get a lot of people injured, a lot of muscle pulls in a situation like this if you're not properly warmed up.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent point. And I think right now we have the specialists coming out to warm up just like they do in pregame. So I think that's the kind of timing we're looking at. The rest of the team isn't even out here yet.
Take a look at some other scores from around the country. Virginia Tech on top of North Carolina. Rutgers went down and won at Chapel Hill last week. Auburn leading Mississippi State 7-0. Akron on top of North Carolina State. Speaking of Akron, defending champs in the MAC. And Central Michigan plays Akron next week. And Brian Kelly, the head coach of Central Michigan, was telling me last night, said, you know, this is a real big game here at Michigan for us, but that game next week in the conference technically is even bigger.
Yeah, everyone's talking about Notre Dame and Michigan next week and kind of a trap game here. Central Michigan is looking forward too, because they're the champions right there, Akron from a year ago.
Illinois made a tremendous comeback and won in overtime over Rutgers in Champaign last year. A bitter defeat for Rutgers. Well, you could tell the Scarlet Knights have not forgotten, and they are putting a whooping on Illinois in the second quarter of that game. And just underway, Miami of Ohio, Purdue, and Kent State and Army, along with West Virginia and Eastern Washington, New Hampshire, Northwestern, a little bit later start. Big Ten was 11-0 last week. That's the first time they've started a regular season 11-0. And here come the Wolverines.
For the second time.
Yeah. I don't think they're going to bring the banner out for this one, though. Again, it's been a little bit over a half hour since the last lightning strike in the area. The skies have brightened somewhat here. Looks like that weather has pushed off to the east and south of Ann Arbor, and hopefully we'll be ready to go in short order here.
So, Wayne, in a situation like this, if you're the underdog, does this delay hurt things for you, or do you get a chance to get a little taste in your mouth of what it's like to be in the big house? You get to go in and talk about it. What's your thought about that?
Well, I think you get a chance to talk about it. I don't see where it would hurt you necessarily, but don't forget the Wolverines were talking about it too, as Bo Schembechler said.
Yeah, you get a chance to talk about it, but you don't necessarily have any more answers than you did the first time this game started.
Yeah, exactly. I think, though, that what they were doing with Bazine, moving him around, getting him away from, as far away from Jake Long as they could, is a good thing. And obviously Michigan will probably be looking to make an adjustment there. I don't know, maybe you would do it with a tight end on that side, or you might just have your running back cheat to that side in terms of picking up, helping out on the block of Bazine. But I'm not sure who this favors. I I can't see how it would hurt the underdog, but I don't know if it would favor them either.
You know, I think one main area for this game is the redshirt quarterback in LeFevre. I think it helps him because you get a taste of what it's like. You get knocked around a little bit. You've already had one sack and a fumble. Now you get to go in and say, you know what? It's not that bad.
Yeah.
You know, 110,000, it's okay. It's still a football game. The dimensions of the field are still the same. I think that really helps him. And it may even expand what Brian Kelly feels like he can do with him today, because you don't very often get that chance to regroup to that extent.
10-minute clock just started here, so the two teams will get 10 minutes now to loosen up and warmed up and ready to go. 10-minute play from play, and local stations, we are not going to be breaking at 1:30 p.m., so please stay with us. We had planned a break. If there was going to be a longer delay, we were going to go back to the network stations. However, that will not be the case. We'll keep it right here and be ready to go when play resumes. You know, we mentioned, and Bo Schembeck mentioned, they're getting ready for a game against Notre Dame. They played Vanderbilt last week here. The Wolverines playing Central Michigan this week. He wonders, does that get you ready to play Notre Dame on the road? We'll see.
Yeah, that was a great point. And last season, some of those losses, Notre Dame, Wisconsin, Minnesota, those are some of those that added up to 7-5 a season ago. They jump right into it.
Notre Dame next week, and then you can see Wisconsin comes to town, and that'll be a big ball game to open Big Ten play for both sides, but I think also Wisconsin. That's a fairly young team right now, Wisconsin. It's going to be a good defensive team. They've got question marks on the offensive side of the football. They've got big backs to run the ball and an exciting freshman runner in Lance Smith, who probably will be the home run hitter when it's all said and done. However, it's early season, and they're going to come to Michigan, and that'll be a huge test. I think we'll find out more about Wisconsin that day than we do about Michigan.
I think we'll find out plenty about Michigan next week against Notre Dame, but Notre Dame, Wisconsin, Minnesota were three of the five teams of those five losses of 21 points collectively. The other two were Ohio State and Nebraska in the Alamo Bowl. That's what led to some of the changes here. Michigan finding a way to win the close games. By and large in college football, especially in the Pac-10, you're going to have to win the close games at the end in the fourth quarter.
And again, we're about to come up on 1:30 here this afternoon, but stations, we are not going to be breaking at 1:30 Eastern time. We're going to stay right here. Play will be resuming inside of 10 minutes, so please stay with us. Well, we mentioned the Wolverines, Central Michigan. I talked about my conversation with Brian Kelly last night. He said, yeah, this is a big game here. Certainly the Boston College opener was a big game at home, but Akron next week, now that's the biggest game of the early season when you talk about conference play.
Yeah, when you're talking about winning your conference, that's the first thing that you have to take care of. That's the first goal, and the championship in the MAC goes through Akron. J.D. Brookhart, the head coach there, a former teammate of mine, doing a very, very good job with that program. And right now, they're ahead of North Carolina State on the road. It's not an easy place to play either.
All right, Kelly. Play will be resuming shortly. Michigan leading on a weather delay in the first quarter. Stations, let's go to break six, and we'll be back after these messages. .30 to go, first quarter. Play will resume in a little bit less than 4 minutes here at Michigan Stadium. The first weather delay in the 79-year history of this stadium. Mike Hart got off to a good start for the Wolverines on the initial drive of the ball game earlier this afternoon. A 12-play, 63-yard excursion. And there's the quarterback, the redshirt freshman quarterback, Dan LeFevre for the Chippewas. He also had some moments early in the first quarter moving his football team down the field before a turnover turned it around. Michigan coming out for the second game of the season at home. And then it was Chad Henne getting himself on track. Steve Breston, the fleet wide receiver on the flank. And then to the tight end. Michigan tight ends have always been good pass catchers. And Ecker made that reception right there. That set up the 4-yard touchdown run by Mike Hart. And Michigan had the early lead. Meanwhile, the option, this was on third down, and Ontario Sneed broke it for 25 yards to the 14-yard line of Michigan. But then on this play, Lamar Woodley came out of nowhere, sacked the quarterback, forced the fumble, and it would be Woodley who would eventually recover the fumble at the 49-yard line of Michigan. The Wolverines motored from there, and then the rains came, lightning in the area, and both teams headed off the field. This is live. Chad Henne finishing warm-ups. Set to go in a little bit less than 2.5 minutes.
You know, in that highlight package, we saw Michigan take the opening kickoff and go 12 plays into the end zone. They did the same thing last week against Vanderbilt. 10 plays and 81 yards, but then they kind of stumbled around the rest of that game. They didn't look sharp. And on the other side of the ball, Central Michigan, they really weathered that storm, the sack and the fumble by Lefevre, but his defense held. And so I think they had some positive things if you're a Chippewa fan. But right now, it'll be interesting to see how they react to very unusual circumstances.
First weather delay, as I mentioned, in the history of this stadium. And about a 1 hour delay. Much of the crowd of 100,000 back into their seats. Wolverines have completed their warm-ups. Chippewa still getting set to go. Where do you put 109,000 or what?
Well, it looked like only about half of them sought refuge somewhere else.
Yeah, exactly. Especially those in the upper reaches of the stadium sought refuge to get out of harm's way. And Michigan's led the nation in attendance 31 of the last 32 years. 194 straight games with 100,000 fans dating all the way back to 1975.
And it's my first trip here to Ann Arbor in the Big House. And what's interesting is the stadium really doesn't look like much on the outside because it's set down in the earth a little bit. But when you get inside, it is an absolutely massive place.
It really is. And part of the reason why they've had trouble growing grass here has been because it does sit low on the water table. And so they have the new turf in here now that is artificial turf, but it's a kind of turf, sport turf, that I think is outstanding. It's not the old hard AstroTurf of the Bo Schembechler days, but it's a very playable surface that a lot of teams I know and a lot of schools and NFL teams have in their practice facilities, and is a very, I guess, player-conducive surface.
It really is, and once it gets settled in, it's really hard to tell between the field turf and the real stuff. When you play on it, it gives you that same feel that regular grass does.
Central Michigan against 10th ranked Michigan. Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor. If you've just flicked us back on, Wayne Larrabee, Kelly Stauffer. Michigan leading 7-0, taking over first and 10 at the Chippewa 43. Steve Breston, the wide receiver, in motion. Hart around the end, ushered to the chalk marks by Curtis Cutts, the strong safety out of Ford City, Pennsylvania. Gain of 5.
And Wayne, offensively, Michigan starting right now the way they started the game. Double tight end. They have both 89 Ecker and 85 Butler in the game. And what it is we're going to punch you in the mouth type of offense and see if you can do something about it.
They lighten up just a bit on the line, move in an extra wide receiver. Three receivers set on second down, but it's Hart who gets a block. To the outside, Hart got the first down, out of bounds at the 32-yard line. Josh Gordy steered him out. Reuben Riley sprung him with a block on the flank of that play, 6-yard gain.
The wide receivers working hard downfield as well. Adrian Arrington and Steve Breston were doing a tremendous job out on the edge.
One thing you'll notice, Kelly, about the Michigan wide receivers, and that's as much a tradition as anything around here, they will block downfield.
And that mental toughness that offensive coordinator Mike DeBoard was preaching to these guys. Size doesn't have any, or toughness doesn't have any size requirements, and you see it here in the wide receivers.
On first down, Henne. Breston could not hang on. At least 4 drop passes a week ago, 3 of which were pinned on the receivers by Lloyd Carr. But there were at least 4, maybe 5, in the ball game in general last week against Vanderbilt.
Wayne, there are so many moving parts in the passing game. Sometimes it's the last thing to really come along, and you saw it right there. Just a little extra movement by Breston made that throw an inaccurate pass and a dropped football.
Second down and 10. Brady is the tailback. Chippewa's coming on a blitz. Brady breaks a tackle, spins his way nicely down to the 15, to the 25-yard line. Pacino Horn made an undercut move on the tackle. A gain of 7, third and 3 coming up.
And a key to this game for Central Michigan is to control the line of scrimmage, particularly in run downs, which that was. Second and long is a maintenance run for a team like Michigan. You want to get into third and manageable, which they were successful on that play.
Central Michigan lost a ton of yardage on a sack earlier in the first quarter. Third down. Hart returns to the backfield, and he gets the call. Mike Hart driving, but I don't believe he's got the first down. Stopped about a yard short. Mike Brown, Red Keith, couple of linebackers on the stop along with Evan Brownie.
Well, on that first drive that resulted in a touchdown in the beginning of this quarter so long ago, Michigan went for it on 4th and 7. You would expect him to go for it right here.
Obi Olibo, a fullback, along with Tyler Ecker and Carson Butler, two tight ends in the ball game. Michigan going for it on 4th down, 4th and about a yard. Hart, penalty marker down. Hart is pulled back. Penalty marker down. He did not get the first down. Keith coming in from that linebacking core. Last week he had a team high 15 tackles against Boston College.
Offside. Number 6 on the defense. If 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
Mike Brown just cost the Chippewas big time.
Wow. Do everything right except line up on the right side of the ball. The Chippewas are walking such a fine line when you come into this big house and try to win a game. And when you just line up a pre-snap penalty, the line up offside is just unacceptable.
It can kill you. And those types of penalties, those types of problems can kill you. First down now for Michigan to the 18-yard line of Central Michigan. Olibo, the fullback. Mike Hart right up the middle. To the 15, to the 10, to the 5. Touchdown! After Ike Brown lines up offsides on 4th down for Michigan, giving the Wolverines a first down, 18-yard run by Mike Hart. And the extra point is good. Hart off to a grand start here this afternoon.
That looks like a carbon copy of how they started this game. Another 12-play drive that gets in the end zone. But what a tremendous mistake by Ike Brown, trying to get up to the line of scrimmage to make a play. And this is the result. When you give a good team, a heavy favorite, an extra punch, generally they're going to deliver a heavy blow, and that's it right there. Right now, the line of scrimmage is by and large being controlled by Michigan, especially when you give them an opportunity to take advantage of a big mistake. And Ike Brown is at the very top there, Wayne, I believe,
yep,
on the line of scrimmage, and just flat loses concentration before the snap. He's in that neutral zone and gives Michigan an unearned first down.
Brian Kelly goes back to work. His Chippewas will have it offensively. They were moving on their initial drive. Ike Brown returns the kick. Brought down short of the 20-yard line. Darnell Hood, a cornerback, makes the tackle for Michigan.
Ike Brown returning the kickoff for Central.
Ike Brown is down, too. It looked like his right knee went out from under him as he tried to make that cut. That will be a tremendous blow because he's the drop linebacker. He plays all over the field. He's a speed guy. He obviously has the speed to drop back and return kicks as well.
Yeah, there aren't many linebackers, and of course he was a safety at one time in his career. Aren't many linebackers that return kicks. Jimmy Jasmine, who returns kicks normally for the Chippewas, is out of this ball game due to an injury. And now Ike Brown gingerly heads off.
You can see the cutback right there, and his right leg just did not look good. And Ike Brown is going to be a safety probably at that next level. He's a true 4-4 guy.
Well, the Chippewa offense has to pick it up. First down of the 18-yard line of Central Michigan. Lefevre over the middle for Anderson. Penalty marker down. He was being ridden by Ryan Mundy.
Suspended for Marcel Archer. There is a penalty flag on the play.
Anderson has been a favored target today.
Pass interference. Number 21 on the defense. By rule, the ball will be placed at the spot of the foul with an automatic first down.
First Michigan penalty of the game.
And Mundy is part of really what's the nickel package for Michigan's defense. Three safeties come in the game, most of the game against a team that runs this spread option offense like Central Michigan does.
Lefevre to Sneed. Hit in the backfield by Taylor. Sneed did well to get back to the line of scrimmage in a yard. Rondell Biggs put him away.
Rondell Biggs on the stop along with Terry.
Wayne, with this type of offense that Michigan is running, they do a lot at the line of scrimmage that Central Michigan is running, like they are right here. A lot of responsibility for a young quarterback in Lefevre. I don't know that his decision-making really warrants this type of responsibility.
Second and nine. High snap. Sneed coming again. Fumbles the football. Wolverines all over it. They've got it. Alan Branch stripped the football, and David Harris recovered it. Lamar Woodley joins in the celebration, and Michigan takes over at the 33-yard line of Central Michigan.
You can't make these kind of mistakes if you're a heavy underdog and have a chance. There's nothing fancy right there. Branch does a good job of getting off inside and coming really from the slightly backside to make a play, but you have to secure the football. If you're the running back, you're not protecting against the guys you see. You're securing the ball from the guys you don't see.
First down for the Wolverines. Henny to Manningham. Inside the 25 to the 21-yard line. First down, Michigan Wolverines. Lapsley, Jonathan Lapsley made the stop. 13-yard gain. End of the first quarter. Affiliates break seven. It's an all-local break. Michigan playing on the lead, breaking on top with their defense in this first quarter. Lloyd Carr's team up 14-0 and about to go in for more. They have it first down at the 20-yard line of Central Michigan. Chad Henney, as you get a look at Central Michigan's turnovers already this season with four and 10 all of last year. Chad Henney has just passed Jim Harbaugh, fourth all-time leading Michigan passer in yardage. Only Navarre, Gerbach, and Todd Collins are ahead of him. Kevin Grady breaking tackles. A gain of nine to the 11-yard line.
You have to do the little things right if you're Central Michigan to have any chance today, and they're already doing most of the little things wrong. You have to secure the football, and you have to tackle well, and they're not doing either one at a high level right now.
Just the start of things, second quarter. Wayne Larrabee, Kelly Stauffer. There's the note on Chad Henney, just passing Jim Harbaugh. Second down and short. Grady able to slip Stephen Friend's tackle attempt in the middle of the line. And he has a first down inside the 10. First and goal, Michigan.
You see the difference in the style with Grady comes into the game. He's more of a bruiser. He has some quick feet. 216 pounds versus Michael Hart's 196. And you can see that Grady knows how to apply that extra weight very well.
Yeah, he's a load. No doubt about that. Brandon Miner, the true freshman out of Richmond, Virginia, is the tail of the tandem in the eye and first and goal. Miner coming right at the defense up the middle. Doug Press got there first from the linebacking court. Big Jake Long.
Yeah, Jake is getting lathered up upside. If he can get hands on people, there it was really away from the play. That's the backside. And that's a lesson in securing the backside. Give him a swat, move him out wide, and then when he peels back, get him in the ear hole.
Gain of two on the previous play. Second down and goal to go. Football just inside the 7 of Central Michigan. Grady doesn't go down on the first contact ever. He has yardage inside the 5. It'll be third and goal inside the 3. Doug Press again in on that tackle along with Josh Gordy, number 19. Central Michigan defense has been on the field a lot here today.
Yeah, too much. The offense hasn't done much of anything. 19 total yards on the day. And this is where there's a big separation. There's a big difference in the depth of these football teams. And when that defense has to be on the field that long, it's going to be very apparent that there isn't as much and as deep talent with the Chippewa football team.
Third and goal. Grady. Touchdown. Six plays, 33 yards. Garrett Rivas, the point after. Kevin Grady scores for the Michigan Wolverines for the second time today, and he does it behind big Jake Long, number 77. Michigan by 3 touchdowns. Kevin Grady's second touchdown of the season, not his second touchdown of the game. Moments ago, has put Michigan on top 21-0. Deep kickoff. Downed by the Chippewas. They will accept to the 20-yard line, first and 10.
Eric Frazier fielded the kickoff and downed it to the end zone. It will be put in play at the 21st.
Central Michigan, there you see the scoring drive, and that has a lot to do with Central Michigan's offense putting their defense on the field way too often. Michigan is going to flat wear out the Chippewas on the defensive side, and two 12-play scoring drives cut it in half. You didn't have to go very far.
To embellish your point, time of possession, 12:46 for the Michigan offense, 4:50 for the Central Michigan offense. Snead going nowhere and a penalty marker thrown to boot. In the area of holding,
I think it's actually going to be face mask.
Okay.
Terrence Taylor, 67, had all he could fit in his hand that time.
There is a penalty flag.
Personal foul. Face mask. Number 6 on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot and an automatic first down.
I blame the wrong guy. Prescott Burgess that time. It looked like it was Terrence Taylor. The result is the same. See if we can get a look right here. The read option, there's a little running room inside, and that was 67.
Lefevre to the sidelines. Damian Linson has a first down of the 48-yard line. Inside the coverage of Leon Hall. 13-yard gain.
Central Michigan desperately needs their offense to get a drive going here. You can see the ISO. Just use your speed to press them. Come out of your break. Nice throw, nice catch. Linson does a very nice job of running the route, but a very accurate throw by Lefevre.
Michigan coming on the blitz with Adams. Pass goes the other way and overshot Satoot. Obed Satoot was open underneath the coverage of Charles Stewart, but the pass was hurried, and it is a second and 10.
Yeah, that's the good word for it. The pass was hurried. Lefevre really wasn't ready to deliver that throw as early as he had to. Satoot had pushed the defender off and was open, but Lefevre airmailed the ball.
Lefevre 5 of 9 passing in a naked shotgun. Everybody out for a pass. Nice throw over the middle. Damian Linton's got a first down. Inside the Michigan 48-yard line. Jamar Adams made the tackle.
Well, Wayne, this is just what the doctor ordered for Central Michigan. But they're getting it done in a slightly different way. Not really concentrating on the run, but throwing the ball down the field. Notice the protection. That's where it starts. And then the redshirt freshman Lefevre delivers a nice throw.
15-yard gain, first and 10. Blitz coming again. Dangerous throw there off the hand of Linton with Wolverines all over. They came hard with the blitz. David Harrison, Ryan Mundy.
And you can see the defensive coordinator Ron English from Michigan is not letting Lefevre get comfortable. As soon as there's any semblance of pass protection or time to throw, they bring the pressure right off the right corner. Harris, and there's Monday. Don't allow Lefevre to get comfortable.
Second and 10. Again, another blitz. Lefevre hesitated for a moment. He who hesitates goes down back near the 38-yard line, a loss of one. Mundy, among others, in on that sack. We are at the Big House, Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, where we endured a one-hour weather delay. Central Michigan against 10th-ranked Michigan. Along with Kelly Stauffer, I'm Wayne Larrabee, our entire ESPN Plus crew on hand. Third and 11 for the Chippewas.
Ron English has come after him the last two times. You come again.
They roll out Lefevre. Going deep, has a man out there, and a leaping grab for a touchdown. Justin Gardner. They beat Mundy and Engelman. 38-yard score. Justin Gardner, the junior out of Kalamazoo, Michigan, 6'2 and 190, and he went up between defenders for that pass. Albreski for the extra point. And it is good. The Chippewas get up off the mat. 80 yards in 6 plays in 2 minutes and 1 second time of possession. Kelly?
It seemed to me that Michigan actually had Gardner doubled. You'll see Monday 21 and Engelman 30-31 right down the middle of the field right there. Mundy gets turned around just a little bit on the coverage. Actually, it was 31 Engelman. Here's a good look at it. Start outside, and then it's the throw inside. But Engelman, 31, overran that post route by Gardner, giving him an opportunity to get a little bit inside. And then in the end, it was all about going up and making a play on the football, a play that his team desperately needed.
That's got to settle down that kid, too. Dan Lefevre, the redshirt freshman quarterback.
And he looked very good on that drive. And the different component that was there was time to throw the football. He can deliver it. He's making good decisions. You have to give him consistent time to do it.
Kickoff in the air. They're trying to pin Breston to the sidelines. He's across the 20, has it open. Upended across the 35-yard line. Josh Gordy made the tackle. Michigan starts in good field position off a 37-yard kickoff return by Steve Breston.
We know Breston can do this. The Chippewas doing a good job of pinning him to the sideline, but then you have to hold in your lane and bring him down. Breston has a very good knack of finding a little seam, and on special teams and kickoff returns, punt returns, it's about seeing the seam, making the initial guy miss, and then it's just hit the gas pedal and get all you can get.
So the Wolverines first and 10 at their 38-yard line, leading 21-7. Chad Henne, lots of time. Dropped by Mike Hart. Well, if you're the quarterback, you hit him right between the 2 and the 0 on his jersey, and sometimes that happens.
Hart is outside the second receiver. Put it right on him. That was a hot one. There was some mustard on that from him, and he has a strong arm. But sometimes you have to recognize who's on the other end. Running backs and tight ends can't necessarily catch the same pass that your wide receivers can.
They don't have to stick him?
I don't think so. I don't think they issue the stick him to those guys.
Hart makes up for it. Cruising 10-yard run to a first down, or very close to it. And he delivered the blow on Curtis Cutts and Pacino Horn.
Well, Wayne, that's where Central Michigan has to win. On first down, they won with a drop ball from Michael Hart, but then you have to win on second down and force Henne into a third and long situation, and they're not doing a very good job of that right now.
Hart, 75 yards rushing on 13 carries and 2 scores. Michigan knocking on the Chippewa territorial door. I'm not sure if Mike Ogle was drawn off sides by a flinch by the Wolverines, but
fire to the snap. Ball start. Number 85 on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Carson Butler not only flinched, but he also took a shot.
And when you flinch before the snap, he just actually set his butt down. I don't know for sure. Yep. They obviously classified it as a flinch. But if you flinch before the snap, you deserve to get knocked on your keister.
Spoken like a quarterback who's facing first and 15. Roll out. Little keep play. Wide open. Mike Massey, the tight end, into Chippewa territory. 20-yard gain.
Wayne, this is all about a running game. Play action pass to the left side, and then it's boot back to the right. You can see the tight ends at two different levels. Massey, the second level. And the Chippewas didn't have everyone covered. But it's about the potent running game that you can then be run a play action passing game off of that.
Kevin Grady ran into his own blocker that time. Mark Beal, the center. And a gain of about 3 yards. Stephen Friend arrived on the scene along with the ever-present linebacker Doug Kress, who's having another outstanding game. He had 10 tackles, 5 solos last week against Boston College. There's the quarterback comparison. Henne has been afforded much better protection, and he's had a much more potent ground game to work with and better field position.
Amen to that, brother. That's where it is right now. That's the difference in this football game. Michigan can do what they want in the running game, usually in this kind of down and distance right here.
Sunlight belies the weather delay we had earlier today. Henne, wide open. Breston, first down as he draws a gaggle of defenders at the 19-yard line of Central Michigan. 16-yard play.
Mike DeBoer, the offensive coordinator here at Michigan, is reestablishing the fact that the running game in Michigan sets the table for everything. The double move, and actually Breston comes from the outside after Manningham on the outside clears out with the go route. But it's about the running game. Play action pass on second and long, because your running game has been so productive on second and long.
From the 19 of Central Michigan. Miner. Oh, and he was hammered back. My goodness, that was paint on paint. Curtis Cutts, the strong safety, took the freshman running back and put him on his backside.
Wow. Get ready, SportsCenter, because this is going to be one of those highlights. Absolutely. Bam. And Curtis Cutts talked about how he's all about run support. Number 10, this is run support. You can't support the run any better than that right there.
Ooh,
it was amazing that Miner hung on to that football.
It really is. Second down for Michigan. Off the gain of about 7. Miner hit in the backfield this time. Coming across clean on the play was Larry Knight, a defensive end. But take a look at the previous play. You hold on to the football here.
You want to play this game? Oh, my. That is incredible. You see guys get hurt in different situations in games, but because of stuff like that, you wonder how we even play this game anymore. They're so big and strong and fast, and collisions like that are amazing.
A moment ago, as you get a look at the red zone numbers, 3 for 3 for Michigan today. The first tackle for loss by Central Michigan a moment ago sets up this third down and long. Penny under pressure being chased by Bazine, and Dan Bazine, who led the nation in tackles for loss, gets a sack here as he takes the quarterback down back outside the 20-yard line, a loss of 3. Daniel Bazine, second in the nation in sacks with 16, first in the nation in tackles for a loss with 26.5 last year.
Bazine has been close today, not in the face of the quarterback, but it's the speed to chase the quarterback down the backside. Bazine can do it all. He can beat you at the point of attack, and then he can chase you down from behind.
Garrett Rivas with a 37-yard field goal attempt. He's got it to the upright, and it is good. Michigan denied the end zone by some tough defense in the red zone by Central Michigan, but the Wolverines extend the advantage.
Now,
Michigan increases the advantage on a 38-yard, officially 38-yard field goal by Garrett Rivas. Ross Ryan set to kick it away. Eric Frazier has some running room. Eric Frazier out across the 40-yard line. They're going to spot it near the 45. 44-yard return. Well, Jimmy Jasmine is out due to injury. Ike Brown is out due to injury now.
Tremendous job, and the Chippewas are doing enough to stay in this game, but they have to stop shooting themselves in the foot. Their foot, very good return, timely. That offense has momentum. Give them good field position and see if they can capitalize once again.
Eric Frazier, redshirt freshman from British Columbia. Pass overthrown, incomplete on first down. You mentioned mistakes have plagued Central Michigan here today. This is early in the ballgame of the first drive. Lefebvre gets sacked after a 24-yard run by Snead. Woodley makes the sack and eventually recovers the fumble near the midfield marker. Now this is Brown lining up offside to the top of your screen. The play, they stopped Michigan on 4th and 2 right here, but the infraction away from the ball cost the Chippewas first down. Michigan scores a TD. Then a fumble here on the hit, and Michigan recovers once again. Shovel pass, here comes Snead. Ontario Snead across the midfield marker into Michigan territory on a gain of about 8. David Harris, Charles Stewart on the stop for the Michigan Wolverines, and it's 3rd and short coming up. Here we go, 3rd down and a little bit more than a yard. Snead stacked up. Harris filled in from the linebacker core. That took an awful long time, that play. And of course, at the front of it was Alan Branch, a 3-technique defensive tackle.
We talked about some of those questionable coaching decisions last week. How about right here? They're running the punt team on, and they're going to punt this ball away. I like this decision at this point in time in the game.
Again, on 4th and 1, I wouldn't be surprised to see Brian Kelly call for the fake here. Low snap. Mikulic gets it away. It backs up inside the five. Breston had everybody decoyed and thought he was going to make the catch near the 15. But McCullough put some Velcro under that one, and it backs up at the 3-yard line of Michigan. That's where the Wolverines will put it in play. By far their worst field position to start a drive.
It's interesting sometimes how you're rewarded for good decisions. This is a good decision by Brian Kelly to punt this football away. He's rewarded by pinning Michigan deep. Now Central Michigan's defense has a chance to reestablish field position and give your offense the short field in which to do something, try to get points on the board.
Michigan's worst start prior to this was its own 33-yard line. Kevin Grady running hard out across the six, gain of 3. It's apparent that obviously when you're going to run right at the defense, you do it with Kevin Grady. When you go off tackle, you're doing it with Mike Hart. And when you're looking for a home run swing, usually it's Brandon Miner.
You have it figured out, don't you?
You know, I'm nothing if not slow.
Well, this is the down that Central Michigan has to win on. They haven't been doing it yet today.
Grady again. Met in the middle of the line. Nice play made by Ronnie Ekdahl, the nose guard. Former walk-on, rewarded with a scholarship following the 05 season. Third down for Michigan. Now, here's the key to this whole sequence here. From the punt that backs up inside the five, what you have to do defensively is stop Michigan on third down and get the ball back in good field position.
You're right. Backed up offense, which Michigan is right here, is about getting, first of all, one first down to try to give your punter room, and then you go off of that. Central Michigan has to prevent that one first down, and that's not a very good way to do it.
It looked like Jake Long or Adam Krause moved prematurely.
With Carson Butler, the tight end, to the left
side. Prior to the snap, full start. Number 85 on the offense.
That was Carson
Half
Butler.
The distance to the goal, still third down.
Fourth Michigan penalty. These have all come since the weather delay. Oh, yeah.
No fair getting a head start in this game. But right now, Central Michigan's defense has an opportunity to get after the passer. They haven't been able to do that much today, but I would be alert for something quick, even a screen right now, to slow down that pass rush.
Third and 9. This is huge for the Central Michigan defense. Henny, not going anywhere. Stephen Friend recovers, brings him down after a gain of 1 yard. To the 5-yard line or just across the 5, it is fourth down.
See, Wayne, there's a great example of what Central Michigan has been trying to get to. Force third in a long situation and force Henney's offensive line to prove that they can protect him. And Central Michigan wants to unleash that pass rush. Bazine and other guys, but they haven't had many opportunities to do that.
Inside of 2 minutes to go in this first half. Ross Ryan gets it away. Damian Linson from the Michigan 48 dancing at the 45. Nowhere to go. David Harris brings him down one-on-one near the 44. 42-yard punt well covered, 4-yard return. Elsewhere, Virginia Tech moves on top of North Carolina. Auburn has the advantage on Mississippi State. Akron with a third quarter lead at NC State. Rutgers all over Illinois in the third.
Ron Zook still having issues up there.
Miami of Ohio and Purdue are scoreless in the second. And Army leading Kent State by a touchdown in the second. Right here, Michigan leads it 24-7. First down at the 44-yard line of Michigan for Central Michigan. Best field position for them to start a drive. Lefevre. Trying to go deep as receiver went down on incidental contact. No flags. Satoot, the intended receiver, went down near the 15-yard line.
Satoot, I think, had a step or two. He's the speed guy. He's going to fake to the post, 1, 2, 3 steps, and then back out to the corner. Keep your feet. There was an opportunity to get deep right there. Wouldn't that have been a big play?
It was not incidental contact. He just slipped. Second and 10. You're right, he had Charles Stewart beat. Nice throw right there, and they're ruling incomplete. Could not hang on Damian Linson as he went out of bounds.
That's how just a foot or two in this game makes a big difference. Linson runs a nice route, but watch where the ball is on his back shoulder. He almost makes a great catch, but the red shirt Lefevre has to get that ball out in front of him, and that's a great conversion.
Yeah, you're right. The throw behind him, it was a decisive throw, had plenty of mustard on it, but you don't throw that to the inside hip where the receiver is looking to the outside. Got a timeout taken by Central Michigan with 61 seconds left to go in this first half. If you joined us late, you missed some Michigan scoring and a 1 hour weather delay.
Yeah, we had all kinds of things going on, and some of the people in the stadium forgot to get back in when this game resumed.
Well, maybe they elected not to get back in.
Could be. They started the after party just a little bit early.
You know, we talked about the two teams coming out and getting warmed up after cooling out. Well, you go back to the tailgate, kind of hard to get back in, isn't it?
That's a whole different set of circumstances right there. Sometimes when you've been in a tailgate too long, you can't find your way back in.
There's a 1 hour rain delay, first ever at this stadium, 79 years of Michigan Stadium.
That sure felt a whole lot longer than 1 hour. I don't know about you. You interviewed everyone in the stadium during that break.
We talked to everyone who was left. You know, it was good to see Bo Schembechler, Gary Moeller, Jamie Morris. Third down and 10. Lefevre, good protection, coming back for it. Catch made short of the first down near the 36-yard line by Justin Gardner, who caught the touchdown pass earlier. Charles Stewart had the coverage.
Fourth down, Central Michigan. Charles Stewart covered on the play.
Fourth down at about 2. Lefevre needs another timeout. So on fourth down at about a yard and a half to go, Lefevre takes the second timeout for Central Michigan. They have one remaining.
I don't think they intended to take that timeout. Problem getting the right play, the right personnel, but I don't think it's a bad use of a timeout. Fourth and one, obviously this is the play. You don't do anything if you don't get it here.
You can't carry it over to the second half anyway, so why not use them?
But Gardner on that third down play, sometimes people talk about, well, he didn't get deep enough. Well, there's timing between the route and how much time the quarterback has. Trust me, Gardner didn't have time to run a yard deeper. Lefevre didn't have time to hang on to that ball just a little bit longer.
The pass led him back.
Yeah, right, and Gardner came anyway back for that ball as well. And rightly so. It wouldn't have been a completion if he didn't.
It is fourth down for Central Michigan, just outside the Michigan 35. 32 seconds to go in the half. Michigan coming on a blitz. Lefevre on a keeper. Straight ahead move. Lefevre's got a first down and a whole lot more. Down to the 20-yard line of Michigan. A 15-yard run. Leon Hall and Brandon Engelman made the stop. Now they have to down the football here to stop the clock. Or do that. Now they're ready to go. And they stop the clock with 23 seconds remaining.
Now this is one of those situations where that change in the rule, the clock starts with ready to play. It stops after the first down, but it starts a whole lot quicker than it ever did.
23 seconds to go. Can they get off two plays here into the end zone maybe?
I really think they can. They get stuck in bounds. They still have one timeout left.
Lefevre takes it himself. Lefevre trying to get to the outside. He's brought down as time winds down to 14 seconds.
This is where you want to burn that timeout, Wayne.
Now they stop the clock with 10 seconds to go on a 9-yard scamper by Dan Lefevre, the redshirt freshman quarterback out of Downers Grove, Illinois. And my goodness, has he grown up in the last 2 weeks.
You're right, but you can see that the lack of experience showing up right there. If he runs straight ahead, a very good job. This wasn't designed. This is on his own. But run straight ahead, pick up the first down, stop the clock. You can get back up and kill it, and you would still keep your last timeout intact. But he tried to make something happen, get outside. It wasn't there to be done.
All right, here's the story. They're down 24-7 are the Chippewas. 10 seconds to go. Do they have time for one more pass play and then the field goal unit?
I think you do. I think you want to take a shot into the end zone right here. You have Satoud as a 6'4 receiver. It would be a decent matchup. You probably want to go away from Leon Hall, number 29. Your other receiver, Brian Anderson, on the outside is also a big, tall receiver at 6'4.
Whatever you do, you've got to do it.
Do not get caught in bounds.
Short of 10 seconds, yes. Here we go. Third down and about a yard and a half to go. LaFever fakes the handoff, looking into the end zone. He throws, and it's broken up incomplete. Well defended. Jamar Adams got over to get a piece of it, along with Morgan Trench.
The running back is just going to the outside, running a wheel route. Actually, it's a tight end, Sam Williams, 45.
Field goal try. Rick Albreski had a 21-yarder last week against Boston College. And it's to the uprights from 29 yards away. It is good. Rick Albreski with a 29-yard field goal as the first half comes to a close. Well, the Chippewas took a few major hits from Michigan in this game. And as they head off, they are within 14 at halftime. The Wolverines on top, 24-10. Our halftime activities are just ahead. Thanks very much, fellas. We'll be back with more from Ann Arbor. Halftime, Wolverines and Chippewas. Back after these messages. Welcome back to Michigan Stadium, waiting for the Michigan marching band to take part in halftime activities here. We were delayed for an hour due to weather. First time that's ever happened in the 79-year history of this stadium. But we had some lightning in the area. They cleared the field. We were down for about an hour and back on. And Central Michigan competitive here this afternoon with this Michigan Wolverine team, 24-10 the score at halftime. Well, we mentioned in our last segment, we showed you a little bit of a preview of that ball game coming up tonight, number one and number two. And Kelly, you and I talked about it earlier. It's wonderful, I think, for those of us that are fans and observers, that in this day and age in the non-conference season, you see some terrific matchups.
And early in the year, like we talked about, it is pretty amazing. But I think Ohio State, Texas, everything is on the line. You have a veteran quarterback with Ohio State. You have the youngster in McCoy with Texas. You know, sometimes I think it comes down to the decision making. McCoy has a very, very good offensive line, but you can see right there, I mean, that says it all. National championships, one of those two teams are probably going to be there in the end.
Well, and you know, the other thing you made, the point you made earlier today, for those of you who weren't around, Kelly, I thought you brought up a good point. If you're ranked high enough, you can afford a loss early in the season and still be involved down the stretch for the BCS.
Yeah, if the right things happen around you, yes, you're right, because you don't have that far to climb.
What you lose is control of your own destiny.
Absolutely. You have to wait for other people to get knocked off above you.
Hey, you talk about good matchups this week, because later on this afternoon, Penn State will play at Notre Dame, Texas and Ohio State tonight. How about next week? Take a look at the slate coming up next week. Wow. Michigan heads on the road, takes on Notre Dame. You got Florida and Tennessee, an early SEC battle. Same for LSU and Auburn. Nebraska and USC out on the West Coast. And boy, I tell you, just some terrific football in this month of September.
It really doesn't get much better than that. Michigan having Notre Dame, and I didn't really get the sense that they were looking ahead past Central Michigan today in any way, shape, or form. But you're right. If you like college football, which we do, you have it all right there in front of you.
Going to find out a lot about Notre Dame and Penn State today, especially Penn State. Going to find out a lot about Michigan next week, I think, in West Penn. Elsewhere around college football this afternoon, now Virginia Tech all over North Carolina. Auburn shutting out Mississippi State. Akron and NC State tightening up a bit, and Akron will be on the schedule for Central Michigan next week. New Hampshire leading Northwestern in the first quarter of that ball game. That's a bit of a surprise. Rutgers dominating Illinois. And then West Virginia has the edge on Washington, Eastern Washington. Purdue leading Miami of Ohio. Pretty competitive game there. And Army leads Kent State 14-7.
And Akron, I think the championship in this conference is probably going through Akron again. And they're playing very well on the road against an ACC team. That's not an easy place to play football.
So the scoreboard in college football this afternoon. Right here, the Michigan marching band entertaining at halftime. The Wolverines leading 24-10. Welcome back to Michigan Stadium. Wayne Larrivee, Kelly Stauffer, 24-10. The 10th-ranked Wolverines on top of the Chippewas at halftime. Let's take a look at our game summary brought to you by Belt Tire. Trust us, we'll make you happy you came in. That's a promise. Weather delay, the first in the history of this stadium. A rushing yardage heavily in favor of Michigan, already 100, over 100 yards rushing in the first half of play. Central Michigan, 2 turnovers in that first half. That is unlike the Chippewas, who last year tied for the fewest turnovers in Division 1A football. And Michigan in the red zone, as long as the Wolverines have gotten close, they haven't missed yet.
Yeah, Michigan has ran the ball effectively when they wanted to, mainly on second down, that I think is the difference in this game. And the big turnover, Central Michigan is obviously fighting an uphill battle. They can't afford to make hardly any mistakes.
And not just turnovers, but like a penalty. Crucial
exactly.
Down penalty by Ike Brown, who unfortunately went out with what appeared to be a leg injury soon after. That really cost Michigan, that cost Central Michigan.
Yeah, you're right. And you can see the first half highlights. Michigan comes out. I think, Wayne, this is the first time Michigan came out today. 12 play drive, marched it right down the field, highlighted that new zone running scheme with Hart taking it into the end zone in the end. And the Woodley on Lefevre, the redshirt freshman, forces the fumble on the sack. The good news is Central Michigan's defense did not give up a touchdown on that drive. They held serve, which is a great thing. And then absolutely the skies opened up, the lightning, 1 hour rain delay. We wondered how teams would come back after this, looking at the different situation. It looked very similar to the way Michigan started the day. The 12 play drive right here, once again Hart getting into the end zone, and then Sneed, the fumble, not hanging on to the ball. You cannot turn the ball over if you want a chance to win in this place. And then Grady takes it into the end zone. That's capping that turnover that we just saw by Sneed. And then the big play was Lefevre to Gardner. Double cover downfield, but Lefevre did a great job of throwing it up to his receiver. Gardner made a play high on the football. That is exactly what Central Michigan needed at that point in time.
And the numbers from the first half. Don't forget, Central Michigan, that sack and fumble recovery by Woodley. Huge amount of yardage lost there, so the rushing yardage doesn't look very good. Michigan off to a good start, as I mentioned, on the ground. Time of possession heavily in favor of the Wolverines, and the average field position to start a drive, Michigan has been in plus territory more often than not.
Yeah, the time of possession is huge because Michigan has been converting mainly on second and long situations. Central Michigan defensively is winning on first down, but they're doing a horrible job on second down.
Well, both teams are back in the arena. Second half is coming up from Michigan Stadium with the Wolverines leading 24-10. Welcome back to Michigan. Wayne Larrivee, Kelly Stauffer, our entire ESPN Plus crew. 24-10 Michigan, and Lloyd Carr in September. Pretty tough.
Not bad. That'll get it done. They would like to add Notre Dame to that.
Yes,
that 29 mark next week.
Here's the kickoff to start the second half by Ross Ryan. Frazier had a nice return late in the first half. Another good one here. Out to the 48-yard line. My goodness, they may have found something here. Eric Frazier, 42-yard return.
The thing that's so noticeable, Wayne, is nobody from Michigan is getting down. No penetration right there, not a Wolverine in the picture. Look how clean that is. Gardner is the lead blocker. He's still intact in front of Frazier, 30 yards down the field. Very well executed.
Golden opportunity right here.
Absolutely.
For the Chippewas.
You got to take advantage of it.
First and 10 to the 47-yard line of Central Michigan. Dan LeFevre at quarterback. Faked option one way, came back the other way, but none of it was being bought by the Michigan defense, and an excellent play made by Lamar Woodley. Woodley's been playing on a regular basis since his true freshman season. He's in his fourth year. He's a good one.
What Central Michigan is trying to do is take advantage of Woodley's aggressiveness, but I think his experience is reason to go to the opposite side.
It certainly looked like it on that play. LeFevre, everybody's out for a pass. Over the middle, got Linson open. Inside the Michigan 40-yard line, Linson has a first down to the 37-yard line of the Wolverines. 15-yard gain, Engelmann. And Mundy on the stop for Michigan.
Right now, Central Michigan's wide receivers, Linson included, is doing a good job of holding up. Remember, we talked about the difference in talent from wide receivers in Central Michigan to defensive backs for Michigan.
Soft coverage on the corners. LeFevre pitches it to Ontario Reed. Nice open field tackle made by Sean Crable, the linebacker. Pickup of a couple of yards.
Ron English, the defensive coordinator for Michigan, plays a lot of zone in the secondary. I think Central Michigan's wide receivers have proven they can find the soft spot if Central Michigan can also protect the young quarterback.
Ron English in his first season, taking over for Jim Herman, who departed for the NFL. Second down. LeFevre, a little pump and go. Cuts it to. Over the shoulder catch. He caught it. Is it a touchdown? No. I beg your pardon, not Satut, but Damian Linson. He had it for a moment. He says he had it long enough for a touchdown, but now don't forget, they can look at this on instant replay.
Yeah, every play is looked at. The question is, now he never had control of that. I think if Brian Kelly has taken any kind of a look, he won't waste his challenge right here. The challenge is timeout, stop play, and then if it's reversed, it doesn't cost you a timeout, but it does cost you your challenge.
I think Brian Kelly's seen the same evidence we have. That was not a catch. Good call on the field. Or did he? No. They are going to review this.
Yeah, and the distinction is review means it's coming from upstairs.
Exactly.
It's not being challenged.
Exactly, Kelly. That's a great point. This is not being challenged by Brian Kelly and his staff. This is a review called for by the replay officials upstairs.
And I don't think this is going to be reversed. I think the call is good as it was called on the field. But at this point in time, such a big play, you have the technology. Why not take a look at it and make sure you get it absolutely right?
Our production
after review. The pass was incomplete. The play stands as called on the field. Third down.
That didn't take long.
Nope, and it shouldn't have.
So it becomes third down and a little bit more than 7 yards to go for Central Michigan.
To take advantage of the opportunities to make plays. Linson had the opportunity. They had the right play, the right pass. You have to make that play.
He had Leon Hall beaten, and that was a good throw. Third down for LeFevre and the Chippewas. Maybe their biggest play of the game to date. A chance to get right back in it with the Wolverines if they could score on this drive. Blitz coming. LeFevre over the middle. Anderson can't hang on. Would not have had a first down anyway. Prescott Burgess in the vicinity. And they have David Harris coming hard on a pass rush.
And that speaks for why that pass wasn't that accurate. Harris on the blitz. Ron English, the defensive coordinator, is doing a very good job of keeping LeFevre right there. Uncomfortable in the pocket. Don't give him time. When he gets time a couple plays in a row, English brings pressure.
They're going for it on fourth down. Just inside the Michigan 35. LeFevre pressured by Woodley. Could he get away? Apparently not. and they're going to call grounding on the quarterback, I do believe. Penalty marker thrown as he threw that pass. Woodley all over that play.
Intentional grounding. Number 13 on the offense. By rule, the ball is placed at the spot of the foul with a loss of down. First down.
Michigan takes over on a fourth down play.
No, two things in question here. One is, was he outside the tackle box where he could throw the ball away? But you have to get it past
the line of scrimmage.
And I don't think it made the line of scrimmage. He's outside of the tackle box, but it doesn't get back to the line of scrimmage. And actually, I think his knee might have been down before he did anything anyway.
Michigan takes over the 49-yard line, Wolverine territory. Penny, the one-step drop, Preston. On the swing, Preston slips a defender. Inside the 30 to the 25-yard line. Doug Press, the linebacker, finally caught up with him 26 yards downfield.
Wayne, take a look at the accuracy of this pass. That's what makes this play. If you can deliver the ball to Preston accurately and let him get the line of scrimmage moving with all of his momentum, that's the result. Henny didn't do a good job of that last week.
Much sharper this week. First down to the 26 of Central Michigan for the Wolverines. Mike Hart. Nice cut. Curtis Cox saved a touchdown as he collared him to the ground. First down at the 10-yard line on a 15-yard burst.
Well, football's a game of adversity. And right now, Central Michigan has to weather this adversity. Michigan is fixing to put that knockout blow on them that we talked about needed to happen way earlier than this.
Central Michigan did fall behind Boston College 31-10 last week, coming back and making a game of it, but it's much easier done at home than away. Hart again just bulldozes what he can get. Gain of about four just outside the five. Stephen Friend, the big defensive tackle, made the stop for Central Michigan.
And a run like that, Wayne, defines what Michael Hart brings to this team. You can see the day he's had, 15 rushes, 96 yards. Every time he touches it, almost 6.5 yards. But the softness was up inside, and he could see that. He thought about going outside, but at the end of the day, the most productive place was right over top of the center.
Arrington at the bottom of your screen. Manningham at the top. Manningham in motion. Second down. Hart. Following that blue wave inside the five, down near the two. Ronnie Ekdahl did the dirty work up front to bring it all to the play. Red Keith was also there for the linebacking core. Michigan facing third down. And it's not a goal-to-go situation. I misinterpreted that. Third down to the 2-yard line. They could get a first down apparently inside the one.
Well, I would look for more of the same. Jake Long has had a very productive day on the left side. I would look for this run to go that direction.
Dan Bazine is on the other side for Central Michigan, other side of the formation. And they go that way. Hart to the outside. They sealed it well. Untouched to the end zone. Touchdown, Michigan. Touchdown afternoon for Mike Hart.
Well, Jake Long's on the left, and all the window dressing with the motion went to the left. Everybody on the Central Michigan side thought it was going that direction, and obviously it didn't.
After the play, we have a personal foul by number 7 on the defense. Distance to the goal on the try.
Pacino Horn coming off the field, the guilty party. Loss of poise, perhaps.
What they're explaining to Lloyd Carr right now is you will mark it off on the kickoff. You don't mark it off here on the extra point. give them half the distance, but you mark it off on the kickoff.
Bigger penalty that way.
Absolutely. It's supposed to be a penalty. Make the people pay.
Mike Hart looked pretty hot, too, on the sidelines. Garrett Rivas for the point after, and it is good. Central Michigan finds itself in the same predicament they were in a week ago, down by 21. Welcome back to Michigan Stadium. Mike Hart has scored three touchdowns for the Wolverines. First time he's done that since November at Northwestern in 2004. Frazier able to slip a defender, and then he runs into a blue wall. And they storm him back in the vicinity of the 20-yard line. When the day began, there were better than 100,000 inside of Michigan Stadium, but a one-hour weather delay has chased some of them. Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, 10th-ranked Michigan playing host to intrastate rival Central Michigan. Along with Kelly Stauffer, I'm Wade Larrabee. Great to have you with us this afternoon. In the red zone, Michigan's been pretty darn good.
Yeah, that'll work. That'll work over the course of the season. But some of that has been handed to them on a platter by mistakes from Central Michigan.
Chippewas down 21. Lefever rolling out. Woodley in his face. Pass thrown behind Anderson. Good coverage by Jamar Adams up across the 35.
You know, Wayne, good teams take advantage of the other team's mistakes, and Michigan has done a very good job of making Central Michigan pay for those fumbles and bad decisions, penalties, and things of that nature throughout the course of this game.
It's a good point. Dan Lefever has shown a little bit stronger arm than we anticipated, but he is a redshirt freshman and only his second game. Lefever under some pressure from Crable, tried to set up the screen. Boy, David Harris had that clogged up pretty well, forced an overthrow of Ontario Sneed near the 20-yard line, and it's 3rd and 10 for Central Michigan.
Yeah, you got it right. 45 right there. Harris recognized that screen. And if he could have got his hands on it, there was nothing between him and the 20 yards he had to go to cash it in.
Central Michigan, 2 of 7 on third downs, facing 3rd and 10. Michigan on the blitz. Lefever nowhere to go. Woodley blocked the middle. That was the lane he wanted. And it's 4th down, Central Michigan. This game has swung in the last 3 possessions now. Central Michigan moments ago was going in for a score. Matter of fact, Damian Linson dropped the ball in the end zone that should have been a touchdown. Michigan comes right back moments later, scores a touchdown. That's a 14-point swing, and then Central Michigan now will return it to the Wolverines once again. Preston back deep, approaching the all-time punt return record here at Michigan. Penalty marker down. Punt block was on. Kick takes a Central Michigan hop, and it's well covered inside the 35, near the 32, and we will check the flag in a moment.
Illegal formation on the kicking team. Fewer than 7 men on the line of scrimmage. That 5-yard penalty is tacked on to the end of the kick. First down.
Central Michigan runs that unusual formation on punt anyway, and that time they didn't even line up properly.
Michigan in command in the third. The veteran coach of the Michigan Wolverines, Lloyd Carr, looking over a 31-10 lead by his Wolverines here in the third quarter. First down, Michigan. From the Wolverine 37, Kevin Grady straight at the defense. DeRosha makes the tackle. Elsewhere in college football this afternoon, Virginia Tech putting a whooping on the Tar Heels. It's not going to make our director too happy. Akron now trailing North Carolina State after leading most of the day. New Hampshire and Northwestern tightening up as they near halftime. Second down, Wolverines. Any? A little key play. Tight end upended in spectacular fashion. Carson Butler and Terrence Robinson just cartwheeled him. But a 12-yard gain to a Michigan first down.
On the play-action pass, Central Michigan is having a hard time covering the backside receiver coming on the over route. Wow, spectacular dump at the end, and a very good job by Massey hanging on to that football.
First down from the 46. Penny to the sidelines, wide of the mark. Mike Massey, the intended receiver. Back to the scoreboard for you. We didn't quite get through them all. As I mentioned, Northwestern and New Hampshire tightening up a bit. Rutgers has knocked off Illinois. West Virginia, a big advantage on Eastern Washington. Purdue and Miami of Ohio has been a tight ball game throughout. And Army leads Kent State in the third. Michigan looking to add to a 31-10 advantage. Second and 10 at the Chippewa 46. Grady had a big hole for a moment. Press closed it in a hurry. Boy, he's played well in the linebacking core for the Chippewas. Also in on that tackle, Frank Zombo. I beg your pardon, make it to Lathan Williams on the stop. Press and Williams collaborate. Gain of about 5, third and 5 for Michigan.
I think Central Michigan has the ability, obviously, to defend the run. I think early on in this game, they were just on the field too long. I think it wore them down just a little bit.
They were number one in the conference in run defense a year ago. Blitz coming, and the pass gets away, incomplete. Well, I tell you, they got great pressure. I think what they did was they looped Bazine from end up the middle, and he came through pretty much untouched.
And that's what you have to do with Bazine, is you have to get him in a situation where he can go one-on-one. The opposing team game plans for him. They slide protection, they keep a tight end, so you move him around and you loop him just like they did on that play to free him up.
Damian Linson back deep to receive this punt from Ross Ryan. Linson's going to let this one go, and it does carry into the end zone. It'll be first down for the Chippewas at the 20-yard line when we resume. Third quarter in Ann Arbor, Michigan on top. Brian Kelly in his third season leading the Central Michigan program. It's been 13 years at Grand Valley State. First down for the Chippewas, Lefevre. He's found running room only sparingly. Rondell Biggs finds him, and there's a look at Brian Kelly, Grand Valley State. Led that program to a couple of Division II championships. Then got the call from Mount Pleasant to take over the Chippewa program. And has done a nice job. Look at his resume. Second down off the sack, Lefevre. Penalty marker down. Lefevre trying to escape. Not much there. Penalty marker down to the offensive backfield. I would imagine in the area of holding on an offensive lineman.
Holding. Number 74 on the offense. That penalty is enforced half the distance from the previous spot. Repeat second down.
And it looked to me it was 74 Hartline on Woodley. Michigan does a very nice job of moving Woodley around so that the offensive line doesn't have an opportunity to slide protection to his side.
Woodley has been a force here today. Whether he's made the sack, made the tackle, and of course he forced a fumble and recovered a fumble off a sack earlier in the ball game that helped turn things around in a hurry. But on every play, he's been in the neighborhood. I think they're going the wrong direction, Kelly.
Prior to the snap, full start. Number 69 on the offense. Half the distance to the goal, still second down.
When you got guys like Woodley that are getting after the quarterback in a second and forever in this case, that offensive line tends to want to get out, get out of their stance just a little bit early.
And they're down in the student section. See the student area down there, and a lot of noise in that part of the stadium. Those kids didn't leave even during the rain delay.
They did get wet, however. It woke them up a little bit, it sounds like.
They got lathered up pretty good. Second and long. LeFevre. Linson for a short gain. Mundy stacked him up just short of the 10-yard line of the 9. Gain of about 5. Morgan Trent on the tackle. Third down and long.
This is a place where it could be disastrous. Down 31-10. You do not want to make a mistake on your own 10-yard line right here. Young quarterback has to make a good decision.
LeFevre rolling. Going deep. Linson cannot quite catch up with that one at the 40-yard line. It appeared he had Morgan Trent beaten by half a step. But under great duress, LeFevre's pass sailed just a bit on him, and Linson could not catch up.
Once again, LeFevre not being able to get his shoulders square because of Harris right there. When LeFevre has had time, he's thrown the ball very well, but it's hard for a quarterback to be moving to his right, not get your shoulders square to the line of scrimmage because of the pressure.
Mikulic from the end zone, and they spread this protection formation. Michigan rushing just 2. They want to keep it away from Breston, and it caroms out of bounds. So good execution by Tony Mikulic. Did not allow the return by Breston. Ball caroms out of bounds near the 44-yard punt. Well done.
Supposedly this was imported from Canadian football. It's almost like rugby. The rugby kick moved the punter a little bit outside the pocket, almost like you move the pocket with the quarterback. Give him a different launch point and aim it to the sideline to keep it away from a return guy like Breston.
Under 5 minutes to go in the third. Kevin Grady on first down. Beat the tackle attempt of Lathan Williams, and then Doug Press brought him down.
You know, one guy that we haven't talked about is 94 Stephen Fram, the defensive tackle. He plays a 3 technique, generally shaded over a guard, and the reason we haven't called his name is part of the problem for Central Michigan. They're getting dominated by and large at the line of scrimmage by this Michigan front.
Grady, 46 yards rushing on 12 carries and a touchdown. Second down. Miner, the freshman. Cracking inside Chippewa territory to a first down on a gain of about 6 or 7 yards. Lapsley and Red Keith on the tackle. Brandon Miner, true freshman out of Richmond, Virginia. He has the speed in this running back core. Rushed for over 4,000 yards, scored 64 touchdowns during his high school career. From the 43 of the Chippewas, first down. Miner to the outside. Hey, he can lower the shoulder pretty well, too. Brandon Miner took on Calvin Hisong, and it was Miner, number 4, the freshman, who delivered the blow, 14 yards downfield.
You just got to talking about minor speed, but playing the running back position in the Big Ten, you have to also punish defenders. There's the speed to the edge, and right here's the punishment. Bam! You have to make defenders pay for it when they come up to put you on the ground.
He looks like he's going to be a good one. Again, minor into traffic this time for a short gain down to the 26-yard line. Pick up about 2.
You know, Miner's not a small guy. 6 feet, 210 pound freshman. I talked about that defensive line for Central Michigan getting worn out early in this game. And right now, 94 Friend, who's supposed to be that anchor, is back in the game. He wasn't in the game before. 97 Brownie was in the game for him. They're trying to keep those guys fresh. It's hard to do against this Michigan front.
Second down. Michigan gets it back. Jackson got the call. He fumbled and was able to gather it back in. Loss of yardage back to the 29.
See, this play is a snapshot of the difficulty Central Michigan has had. They defend second and long very well right there, but they haven't in the game. And what it has allowed Michigan to do is, even when they fail on first down, they can still run the ball successfully on second down, putting them at a third and short. Central Michigan needs to do a better job.
Mike Ogle forced that fumble. Now it's third and 10. Henny to the air. Henny under pressure, hit by Bazine, gets it away to the tight end, Carson Butler, but he's short of the first down at the 23-yard line. Gain of about 6 yards. Larry Knight, Red Keith on the stop. And they're going to bring on the field goal unit.
Once again, in a third and longer situation, Bazine can get free and get after the quarterback. It's just that Central Michigan's defense hasn't kept Michigan in third and long very often.
This will be a 40-yard field goal attempt for Garrett Rivas. Got it going to the uprights. It is good. So the Michigan kicking game appears to be in good order. Garrett Rivas adds another field goal, and it's 34-10 Wolverines. Forty-yard field goals today for Garrett Rivas. So while Michigan has blown things open, it's not like Central Michigan didn't have their chances here in the ball game today. This is early on after a 25-yard run by Sneed on first down. LaFever sacked by Woodley. Woodley would eventually recover back near the midfield marker at the 49-yard line of Michigan. Then on fourth down, fourth and two, Michigan. That was Ike Brown. He's over the line of scrimmage offside. They stop Mike Hart's fourth down run, but the penalty gives Michigan a first down, and they go on to a touchdown. And then Sneed fumbles here as Alan Branch triggers it loose, and it's recovered by the Wolverines. And how about this one? This would have made it a 7-point ball game, but Linton unable to hang on after beating Hall down the sideline to the end zone. That was in the third quarter early.
And that was that 14-point swing that you talked about. Brian Kelly knows that you have to take advantage of the opportunities given you. They didn't last week against BC, and they certainly haven't this afternoon in the Big House.
Much to the light of those fans. Frazier again. Follows his blocking pretty well, but the picket fence breaks down. Stevie Brown and Mike Massey on the stop for Michigan. And this time Central Michigan will start at its 20-yard line.
That drop touchdown earlier that we just saw in the highlight, remember, it led to a fourth down where LaFever right there was called for the intentional grounding, essentially the loss of down, so it's a turnover. Michigan takes that down, marches down the field, gets seven of their own. Really a 14-point swing.
First and 10 for the Chippewas. Dan LaFever, the redshirt freshman at quarterback. Ontario Sneed trying to sift through the traffic. And Alan Branch, the junior out of Rio Ranch, New Mexico, made the stop. Jameson was also there.
Alan Branch is having himself a nice afternoon. He played well last week. If you can get Branch playing well inside, with Woodley really getting after it on the outside, that's a great combination.
And don't forget about big Rondell Biggs. Sneed, first down and more. Nice finish to that run across the 30-yard line. Pick up of 12, David Harris made the tackle.
No, Wayne, that's the other part of it. That was 12 yards. Before that run, Central Michigan had 5 on the afternoon. That won't get it done. You have to defend the run, but you also have to run it yourself.
Third quarter comes to a close at Michigan Stadium. 15 more minutes to go for the Chippewas and the Wolverines. We'll be back with Michigan on top, 34-10. Score by quarter, Michigan on top 34-10. Start of the fourth quarter. First down, Ontario Sneed. And he gets short yardage to the boundary side of the field, as they say. Adams and Morgan Trent have been busy in the secondary for Michigan.
And Sneed's not a guy that you want going to the sidelines. You want him going north and south. He's more of a bruiser.
Sneed's first carry went for 25. His next seven went for 10 yards. Quick throw and a reach for the first down on the far side by Justin Gardner, who caught a touchdown pass earlier today. Charles Stewart, the defender, and the Chippewas are just short of the first down. Third and one.
Brian Kelly talked about their running game. They like to stretch out the defense and force those defensive linemen to run sideline to sideline. I think Michigan has had the advantage. They're the ones spreading out the run.
Third down. Lefebvre over the top, pass overthrown and intended for Justin Gardner. I would imagine this is two down territory for Central Michigan, and they're going to come back with a running play here. No, they're going to come back with a punting squad. And I wonder if the quarterback called the right player.
You know, I don't think he went to the right place. You had a fade route on the outside by Gardner, matched up against number five Stewart, but you also had a safety on the hatch. That isn't the place you want to go with the safety on the hatch.
So the punting unit is on. Tony Mikulich. When I saw that play, Kelly, I thought, well, maybe they're just going to, you know, go for the bomb on the third down play and run for it on fourth, given the game situation. Mikulich well placed on this punt. This will be down inside the 20. As a matter of fact, inside the 15. So
I think Brian Kelly is trying to get him across. You need to go to the right guy, make good decisions.
Teaching points on the sidelines for the Chippewas.
Now,
welcome back to Michigan Stadium. Wolverines take over first and 10 at their 14-yard line. To the outside, Mike Hart finding some running room. Chad Henney looking to make a block. And Hart is out of bounds. Just short of the 30-yard line. Larry Knight made a long run to force about 15-yard gain.
This is a consistent trademark of the zone running scheme. Going to the left, and then it's the cutback to the right. A couple of missed tackles didn't hurt anything, but that's the vision that Hart has. He has the ability to take advantage of what isn't at the point of attack, but see it to the backside.
You know, when they say a linebacker needs instinct, well, a running back needs vision, and not everybody has it. That's God-given. First and 10 from the Wolverine 29. Henney in a nice pocket. Hart, the only open man. He was decked after a short gain. Lathan Williams made the hit. Pickup of about five. They mark it at the 34 of Michigan.
It's a very good decision by Henney, throwing it to Hart right there. It was what we call all goes. Four receivers in the game, tight ends, wide receivers. They were all going deep. And sometimes that creates some softness underneath to dump it to a guy like number 20 and make him do something with it.
Mike Hart's had a big day today. And he's going to add to it, or try to. This time the Chippewas are ready for him. Gain of barely a yard to the 35. It'll be third down and four coming up for Michigan.
Wayne, that was a flashback to the pass right there. That was the Michigan lead draw. Big old fullback Olibo leading Hart up in there. There just wasn't any running room. But that's more typical of what Michigan has done in the past. The zone scheme is something new.
They brought on Alex Gibbs, the zone blocking guru of the Denver Broncos and now the Atlanta Falcons, to consult. And Mike DeBoard and company, they committed to it right away. The offensive lineman, DeBoard, said they really were excited about it coming out of spring practice. Third down, Henney. Oh, tried to throw the slant, and his receiver Manningham fell down. And a penalty marker thrown very late and far downfield. Pacino Horn may have made illegal contact.
This is so hard to call. A quick slant, it happened so quickly that it's easy for feet to get tangled inadvertently, and I think they're going to pick up this flag, which I think in the end will be the right call.
There is no foul on the play. Any contact was prior to the throw of the ball.
So the punting unit comes on. Take a look at it again, Kelly.
Down at the bottom, Manningham breaking off the quick slant. The question is whether the push by Horn led to Manningham falling down.
And as far as contact goes, as the official said, the ball was not in the air when the contact was made.
That quick slant happened so immediately that the ball wasn't even gone yet.
Within the 5-yard area of the line of scrimmage, where it's where it is legal right to make contact. Yes. Fourth down. Zoltan Mesko, boy, does he have a big leg. Damian Linson back inside his 10. Darnell Hood's had a good day covering kicks today. 54-yard punt. Minus one on the return. Long high punt leads to good coverage. Linson retreats and loses one. Central will start deep in its own territory. Michigan is 10-1 when Mike Hart rushes for 100 yards. I'd say that's a pretty good omen for today. First down for the Chippewas. Dan Lefevre still in at quarterback, and Ontario Sneed got the call straight up the middle. Well, 3 years ago, Central Michigan was in here, and it was Chris Perry who had the big day. 232 rushing yards and a couple of touchdowns. Perry and the Wolverines prevailed on a sunny, sun-splashed afternoon here at Michigan Stadium, 45-7 over the Chippewas. That was only the second meeting between these two schools. The first was back in 1931. Our production crew has spent most of the week looking for footage of that game, but so far none found.
Illegal substitution on the offense. 12 men on the field. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
Insult to injury kind of penalty, I guess.
Yeah, you can only have the 11 that are going to play on the field. You can't break the huddle with 12 and then run somebody off. That's one of the drawbacks of doing everything at the line of scrimmage. Sometimes you end up with one too many or the wrong personnel grouping altogether.
Second down. Lefevre.
Intercepted. Touchdown, Michigan. Max Pollock.
Max Pollock, a senior from Tacoma Park, Maryland. Did he get in? The ball's coming out right there. Had he broken the plane of the goal? That's all that matters. Looks like he did. The extra point try is good. Jason Gingle on the extra point that time.
Well, Wayne, the interesting thing is, why wasn't that reviewed more thoroughly? Because the result would be, if it's fumbled through the corner of the end zone, it's a touchback Chippewa football, and that would not be a touchdown. And it looked like to me, you can see the quarterback's rolling, so Pollock has the ability just to roll with him, getting a great jump on it. But that ball not only, I think, was fumbled before he got in the end zone, but I think it was fumbled through the end zone, which results.
Hard to tell. There it comes loose right there.
That ball's out.
I think you're right. And looking at that for the second time, and that's what Brian Kelly's talking to the officials about. Why wasn't that reviewed? And he's talking to Don Capron right now.
And remember, every play is reviewed, but the game is stopped only for the in two ways. One is it's stopped upstairs by the review committee that say we want to take a further look, or the challenge by Brian Kelly.
Now, Brian Kelly would have had to challenge before the extra
absolutely
point. And apparently there was no challenge there, unless he just couldn't get the attention of the
official.
The
ball is out right there. And unless Pollock had an incredible sprinter's forward lean, that ball was not in the end zone. It's fumbled through the end zone, which would have resulted in a touchback, no touchdown, Chippewa ball on the 20-yard line.
When I first saw the replay, it looked like to me the ball was fumbled after he crossed the goal line. But that, when you look at it a couple of times, you can see where it was real close. The touchdown will stand. Frazier once again, well over 100 yards as a kickoff returner today. And he draws a crowd across the 35. Ross Ryan, the punter, made the tackle. But I tell you what, this kid, 38-yard return, I think Central Michigan found a kick returner here today. Eric Frazier, the redshirt freshman from Burnaby, British Columbia.
Yeah, that's the good news. Look at those numbers. The bad news is the fact that he's had a lot of opportunities to return it because Michigan's up 41-10. Well, Brian Kelly isn't letting that last series of events go by, but he has to refocus and get his team concentrating on the business at hand.
Michigan on top big, and he has put the backup quarterback Dwayne Brooks into the game, and he mentioned that he would probably play Brooks, but not unless either the game got out of hand or Dan LeFever really struggled. Well, the game is out of hand, and Brooks comes in. He's a runner, an option quarterback at high school out of Irving, Texas, MacArthur High School in Irving. Ran track, ran the 4 by 200 meters and the 800 meters in track.
It was an illegal substitution on the defensive side of the ball that time, and this is the time in the game. You're getting a lot of new faces on both sides of the ball. Michigan's defense has totally been revamped in the last series.
So first down to the 41. First and 5, there's the option. Sneed. Michigan playing it very well. Brandon Harrison got him to make this tackle. Dan LeFever today, 14-30. Was sacked a few times, 135 yards, one touchdown, one pick.
And really not a bad afternoon for a redshirt freshman in this environment. He needed some help around him early, and he really didn't get it.
Second down. Snap dropped by Brooks. Comes up firing. Throws a strike into the seam. Damian Linson on the reception, and it's a first down in Michigan territory. Stevie Brown got him down 35 yards downfield. That's the biggest play for the Chippewas today.
This isn't a very big window, especially when your eyes aren't downfield because of the bad snap. But a very, very good throw right in the seam. Very narrow window. You have to get it in there in a hurry, and Brooks does a tremendous job.
41-10 Michigan, coming up on 10 minutes to go in the game. Brooks again throws a dagger, but this one is broken up and a penalty marker down. Broken up by Shakir Edwards or Brandon Harrison. Make it Brandon Harrison. But I think he had an arm on the receiver. His off arm was on the receiver. That's going to be an interference penalty.
Yeah, I think that's a good call. That wasn't the place to go with the football. As much as the last pass was a good one, this wasn't a good decision.
Pass interference. Number 27 on the defense.
So it'll be first down off the penalty at the 20. The penalty bails out the bad decision by the quarterback, Dwayne Brooks.
Brandon Harrison had great coverage, but it's hard to reach across the body of the receiver and not get that left hand on it. And I think that's what happens right there. It's what's going on behind with the left arm. And I think they said he got there just a little bit too early with that left arm.
Five receivers set to spread the defense. Brooks up and throwing, and Anderson incomplete. was a well-timed hit by Chris Richards on Brian Anderson. Timing is everything in sports.
Absolutely. This is in real time. Tell you what, if Brooks doesn't start making better decisions and stop leading his receivers into coverage, it's going to be open season on the wide receivers on the Chippewa side of the football.
Again, a five receiver set. Brooks design play. Yanked down in the open field by Darnell Hood, who's done a good job covering kicks and gets a chance to play on defense. Lloyd Carr was mentioning the new rules shorten games. I mean, they used to average 143 plays a game last year. Last week they had 125 plays total in the game. And he mentioned that, you know, the games are shortened, so I can't in these early season games get experience for some of my backup personnel, at least not as easy as I could. Well, LeFevre comes back at a quarterback. Michigan's had an opportunity to get a lot of people on the field here today. LeFevre, the pass incomplete. Intended for Sam Williams, who cannot hang on. He dropped a couple last week against Boston College. Anton Campbell had the coverage. But Coach Carr, nonetheless, has had a chance to play a lot of people on his roster today.
That's going to be an illegal receiver downfield.
Penalty marker down.
Was covered. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
So Dan LeFevre came out. They had Dwayne Brooks in there for the majority of play calls on this drive, and now LeFevre back in there once again. He returned on the last play. Fourth down and about nine. Anderson for a first and goal down to the 5 yard line. Anton Campbell on the tackle. Good protection led to a 14 yard gain.
LeFevre has done a nice job of finding the right guy and delivering the football when he's had time to do it. The difference right now is a guy named Woodley is out of the game. Very good throw, nice catch, good conversion. But remember, Woodley isn't there to chase LeFevre around in the backfield.
Good point. And LeFevre does not miss him. First and goal at the five. Straight T formation. LeFevre on the handoff. First man through. Not a lot there. Sneed got the call, and he's covered up. Gain of about a yard.
What you saw Brian Kelly do right there, they went to really a full house backfield running the wishbone. I disagree with that. At the down in plus territory, I think you spread guys out and keep doing what you normally do.
It's like the old team. And again, Sneed hesitating and nothing there. Penalty marker thrown on that play. A couple of them, matter of fact.
Yeah, I think you're playing right into Michigan's hands. They're more physical up front, get them all bunched in there, and I think it's going to be tough sledding.
Illegal participation. 12 men participating on defense. That penalty is half the distance from the previous spot. Repeat second down.
How much of that is management on the sidelines?
I think it's a ton of management, because there are guys who are going in the game right now. Am I supposed to be in? Am I not? We're down to the third and four teams on the Michigan side of, in terms of the defensive players.
Second down, football just outside the two. LeFevre rolling. Looking to make a play himself. Take it out of bounds on the far sideline. Loss of two. Back near the 4 yard line. Sean Crable reinserted into the game. Makes the hit. In the red zone last week against Boston College, the Chippewas were 4 for 4, including 3 touchdowns. Today, not nearly as good.
And it was going to take numbers like that to be in this game, taking advantage of opportunities. And here we see that mass substitution again. Don't be surprised if the yellow hanky flies again.
LeFevre over the middle, touchdown, Damian Linson. Well, Linson's been impressive at times here today in terms of beating people off the snap. That time, he beat Chris Richards earlier today. He beat Leon Hall, the All-America, but then dropped the ball to the end zone. This kid has some quickness. If he can hang on to the ball, he's going to be a good one. Linson, six receptions, 87 yards and a touchdown now. Rick Albreski on the point after. So the Chippewas able to score late here this ball game. It's 41-17. Nine play, 64-yard drive will lead to some Michigan teaching points next week as they get ready for Notre Dame.
Coming up on Michigan Replay, the Wolverines go 2-0 on the young season with a win over Central Michigan. We'll have the highlights. We'll also profile an interesting young man who's weathered a number of storms on his way to a starting spot in the offensive line. And we'll look ahead to an early season showdown. We'll scout the Irish of Notre Dame. All that and more coming up next. Michigan Replay with Lloyd Carr is brought to you in part by Absapure Water, delivering quality bottled water since 1908, by Sirius Satellite Radio, by the University of Michigan Alumni Association, uniting the leaders and best, www.umalumni.com, by State Farm, providing insurance and financial services, and by Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Michigan Replay. Well, the Wolverines are 2-0 on the young season, a 41-17 win over Central Michigan. And Coach Carr, you always say the most improvement from a football team is week one to week two. Did you see it against Central Michigan?
Well, I saw it in a few things, but there's still some things to work on, Jim.
I thought you talked last week about the pass protection's got to be better. Now, and Central's got a good front seven.
They really do.
And I thought pass pro was improved.
Well, I think with the exception of one new pass rush done, and as an old offensive lineman, you know you get something different every week. Central had a very good scheme.
Yeah, well, you told me after the game they ran a grand twist. That's where they run that defensive end all the way around the other tackle, and that's tough to pick up with that end, Bazine. He's a good player.
Bazine is an outstanding football player. I think he's got a great future in the game, and Central played very, very hard, very physical game.
The one thing you did, though, and I thought was important in this game, was you came out, got the ball, and you took control immediately in that opening drive.
Well, you know, that's what you always want to do, whether you're at home or on the road, and we've done a good job of that thus far. Chad hits Mario, and Mario had a good day today.
And if they're laying off the corners, you gotta give that ball out there, don't you?
Well, I think it takes a quarterback that recognizes the coverage. Here, Adrian Arrington gets an excellent block. I thought our wide receivers did some great blocking today.
And you're gambling here on fourth down.
Well, yeah.
You're just a riverboat gambler, man.
Well, you know, we were into the wind. And it would have been a very difficult field goal attempt, but Chad found Tyler. And here, the backside, the right side of our line, did a great job sealing the backside. Mike made a great cut, and we take the lead.
And the defense kept their play from a week ago.
Well, here's the only play, the biggest play of the day that hurt us. It's a draw play with quarterback sprinting to his left, and the backside of our defense got to be a little bit more patient.
But they kept making big plays.
Well, here Lamar Woodley makes a great hit on their quarterback. David Harris there making a heads-up play, and Sean picks it up. But this play shows Lamar Woodley got up off the ground after knocking the quarterback down and recovered the ball.
Then you had to leave for an hour because of lightning in the area.
Jim, I was having some hot dogs in there at the half. I don't know about you.
That wasn't even halftime, middle of the first quarter.
That was a long delay, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. We'll talk about that at the end of the first half. Meanwhile, you come back, and then on your next possession, after the rain delay, you pound it right in.
Put a great drive together. Kevin Grady ran extremely hard, and Mike on the draw play with the good block from Obi Olivo got in for the touchdown.
Here's the defense creating a turnover again. Allen Branch causes the fumble. Woodley gets on it.
Well, Allen is a very, very athletic guy, and that's the second fumble he's calling 2 weeks from behind.
And again, if the corners are going to lay off, you just got to get it to the Manninghams and Dressman.
Well, Central Michigan was much like Vanderbilt to the standpoint. They were going to prevent big plays, and that means you have to execute by throwing the ball underneath. Here again, Kevin, I think, is really starting to feel more comfortable in this offense, and he's a powerful guy.
And this is showing him how comfortable he is.
Well,
nice read, yep. Downhill, body lean, the whole thing.
Well, the left side of the line, and Mike Massey is a guy that gets better every day and had a good block.
21 to nothing at this time, and then they get one big pass play.
Well, here the quarterback rolls outside the hash marks and throws back, and our safety took a bad angle and let the receiver back behind him in the deep third. So that's something we got to work on. That's a second big play in 2 weeks.
21-7 at this point. Mike Hart up the middle again for a good 10-yard run. And then you move Mike Massey out of the pocket off a run action.
Well, this is the type of thing, yeah, the Chad finds, he hit some passes today off play action. He hit Steve Breslin in there, Mike Massey. And Mike is, again, a good pass receiver here. He hits Steve Breslin on a well-thrown ball. And when you get all those linebackers up in there to defend the run, it opens some things up in the passing game.
How about that hit? Your freshman back, Brandon Miner, still holds onto the ball. I thought that was big.
Well, you know, he learned from that play, because later in the game he'll see that he gets his pads down a little bit lower. But we stall there, and Garrett Rivas had an excellent day, got the ball up, and made a couple of good field goals.
24-7 at that point. On a 4th-and-2 just before half, they get out there on a quarterback draw.
Well, we were blitzing there, and we ran right by the quarterback. That's a play that you've got to have patience on. And that gave Central Michigan some momentum, Jim, going into the half.
24-10 and a half. Now, had you ever been through a lightning delay like you were in that first half, where you had to sit for an hour?
Well, you know, I told our players at the half that, or at that intermission, you know, there's all kinds of distractions, and if you're a focused football team, because the truth was, when we got in there, we didn't know how long. We thought at first it would only be 15, 20 minutes, and then it extended much longer than that. So I really liked the way that we came out after the rain delay.
And you responded by scoring, so the Wolverines did a nice job. We'll talk a little bit later about that Lightning when we return. But first, we hear from Steve Breslin, who said the CMU game was about getting back to basics.
I was just working on executing on plays. I mean, we knew that last week it was a couple of physical mistakes, and we was able to come out here and you know, catch the ball and run good routes, and Chad was putting it on us, and we just made it happen. It complemented the run real good.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
We knew that coming in that they were going to be a lot better, you know, than the previous team we played. They brought different fronts, different stunts, and, you know, they had a solid front line. So we knew that we had to pick that up.
Coming out of the second half of the game on Saturday, Michigan had a 24-10 lead over Central Michigan, but it was almost like your second halftime. Did you find that weird that you were saying the same things basically a half hour later?
I never repeat myself, Jim, but you know that.
No, and I've, wait a minute now. We've done this show a while. You've done enough repeating that I could almost do a show by memory.
Yeah, well, I can promise you the players are tired of listening to me. So they were excited to get back out there.
Did you break out into individual units at the halftime and just kind of confirm what you wanted to do from your first half?
Well, we did. I can tell you this. I talked to Mike DeBoard on the phone, because our coaches couldn't come down from the press box, although Steve Zabel finally did come down to talk to our players. But, you know, it was a different
deal. Did you get him on the cell phone?
Yeah. Yes, I did.
It's amazing technology.
But one of the problems at first, I got him on a university phone, but all the cell phones, somebody was telling me that when the rain delay came, that 50,000 fans were got on their cell phones.
Oh yeah.
So the service blocked.
I didn't even think of that.
Yeah.
Oh. Let's go to see the second half highlights. The Wolverines, of course, leading 24-10. The one bugaboo you talked about after the game was your kick coverage. You just didn't like it.
No, I didn't. And they took the ball from the short side of the field, brought it back to the wide side, and we overcommitted into the sideline. We got it straightened around in the latter part of the second half. But we've got some real work to do on our kickoff team.
There's Lamar Woodley again, chasing down their quarterback on a fourth down play. He gets the big turnover, and then you take it from there. And this is an impressive drive here.
Well, we get Mario out there. Adrian Arrington, an excellent block. And Steve beats his man and comes up with an excellent game.
Mike Hart continues to run strong.
Well, there's some good blocking. Reuben Riley and Alex Mitchell and tight ends. We ran for 250 yards, Jim, which gave us an excellent time of possession. And here Obi Olebo cuts the corner, the guy responsible for the force, and Mike has an easy touchdown.
That makes it 31-10, and there's just 5 minutes gone in the third quarter.
Well, here we... Rondell Biggs, who got off to such a good start a week ago, came up with another sack. And
Here's that play you were talking about earlier. Brandon Miner in the ball game, your young freshman, and he learned from that hit in the first half.
Jim, he did, and there you can see from the time of contact, he gained another 3 yards. Here he is getting out on the perimeter, and again, got his pads down, comes out, and that's what you want a young back to do. And so he had some very good repetitions.
Drive stalls, but Garrett Rivas, who had a very good day on Saturday, knocks through this 40-yarder, and it's a 34-10 lead.
Well, at this point, we have control of the football. And Zoltan Mesko, I told you one of these
you
days.
You unleashed him.
Well, he hit this with a great punt, great effort down there. By Brandon Harrison.
Well, you talk about Hood. You want to talk about turning field position around. That's a 54-yard punt with a -1 return.
Well, that's the thing he can do so well. He gets such great height on his kicks. And here is one of the highlights of the day. Max Pollock, a senior linebacker, comes up with a big interception. He didn't secure the football, which we'll talk about tomorrow. And his teammates won't let him forget that.
That ball security thing, you're gonna make sure he gets that figured out.
Yeah, right? I'm gonna do that.
Coming out of this game now, how do you feel this team improved? You said after the game, we're a better team Saturday than we were the previous week.
Well, Jim, I think offensively, we have gained some great experience with our some of the new things we're doing offensively. And I think we have established some confidence that we can run the football. I think defensively we've done a good job against the running game. But I think we all understand we're about to head into the real heavy part of our schedule. We've got some games coming up that are going to be great tests for us.
Passing game. Real quick comment. Not where you want it to be.
No, I don't think it is, because I think we gave up another sack today, but I thought Chad Henney threw some excellent throws, and they're a bend but don't break team. So we have yet to be able to get the ball down the field, and hopefully we're going to be able to do that here shortly.
All right. When we come back, we'll meet Adam Krause. But before we do that, we're here from Max Pollock about his interception return for TD. He says he's still kind of like in the twilight zone.
You know what? If I could tell you what I remember, I really don't remember too much about it. It's kind of a blur. I'm sure I'm going to piece the parts together tomorrow when I watch the film, but I don't know. It just was in my hands, and I ran, and I don't remember much about it. It feels great.
It's been quite a journey for Adam Krause at Michigan. He arrived as a highly regarded tight end out of high school, but was quickly moved to guard, then center, now back to left guard, where he is starting. And there's no place he'd rather be.
Anywhere I can get on the field, anywhere that I can help the team win is where I want to be.
So that means right tackle or left tackle or center or guards. I mean, I'll play anywhere.
During his journey, he's had to overcome injury and natural disasters. You see, Adam is from New Orleans, and just a year ago, he had to watch from afar as his family was displaced from their home by Hurricane Katrina.
There's definitely lingering effects. You know, New Orleans is not close to being back to what it once was. And I mean, our house, we haven't moved back in our house yet, so we're still rebuilding there. So there's still a lot that needs, you know, that needs to be done. I mean, as far as the economy and everything, it's not close to what it was. So it's gonna be like that for a while too. It's not anything that's just gonna happen overnight and be done with in a year, so.
Adam is also a young man of faith, and last spring he made a trip he always wanted to make. He traveled to Israel, the home of his faith. The trip was well before the recent violence there, but nonetheless, the experience was profound.
Well, I expected not to feel so safe. Expected it to be a little scary, but I got there and I felt as safe as I do here. And just seeing all the historical sites, and I mean, all this history was an amazing thing.
Now in his senior season as a Wolverine, his focus is on football. And as an offensive lineman, he is determined to make the running game better.
We're aggravated. I mean, we want to get out there and we want to be able to run the ball, you know. Hopefully this year that we'll be able to go out there and do that. That's our main goal, you know. I just want to run the ball and, you know, hush some of the critics.
Well, clearly the Wolverines and Adam Krause have hushed some of the critics with the running game, but I think sometimes what we forget is that these young men have other parts of their lives. Like when you look at what he's had to go through with his family in Hurricane Katrina, those are things that, you know, sometimes get glossed over, and this young man's had to come through all of that and still keep his focus on school and football.
Well, one of the real joys, I think the greatest joys in coaching is the kids that you get to know and the families, and certainly his family. What they've been through, and his father's fighting a battle with cancer, and his sister was in school here first semester a year ago. She's a student at Tulane, but you get some small feeling about how devastating Katrina was when you know what the Krause family went through.
Well, it's good to see them grow up, and we've always said at Michigan Replay, it's fun to see these kids from freshmen to seniors.
Well, Adam Krause in his opening statement there talked about whatever he could do for the team, and he is an ultimate team guy.
All right, when we come back, we will look ahead to those Irish from Notre Dame, but first we hear from Chad Henne. He says he remembers Notre Dame's past.
It all came down to execution, and we hurt ourselves in the last 2 years. And hopefully this year we get the game plan in, and we all execute.
Michigan Replay and Al Rose Steel take you inside the locker room.
It's all business from now on. We can't make any more mistakes. We have to have A-plus effort. We have to be on the top of our game. No missed assignments, no nothing. We have to be perfect to beat all these the rest of our schedule, because the rest of our schedule is tough.
Well, earlier in the show, you heard Coach Carr say you're entering the meat of your schedule. I would say the filet mignon is coming up this weekend with the Irish.
Well, they've certainly been an impressive football team. In the opener, I thought they did a great job in Atlanta in a tough environment, in an opening game. And, of course, they had a great day against Penn State.
And the thing about Notre Dame is that, you know, with a confident team of Charlie Weiss and a great young quarterback, not young anymore, but this guy seems like he's been there for 100 years, but he's Brady Quinn's all that's advertised.
Well, he played against us as a true freshman and certainly developed. Charlie's done a great job with him. And he's got a great cast around him, great receivers. Darius Walker, I think, is one of the finest football players in this country, a guy that's a great pass protector, great running back, and a great receiver.
And Samardzija is a huge asset.
Well, he's an All-American. He's a guy that runs great routes. He's a great deep threat and a target that can go up and make a play even when he's covered.
And defensively, they're still strong. They've got a lot of guys that can get after you. Victor Abiamiri, Maurice Crum, and of course their safety, Mr. Everything, the boxer, Tom Zbikowski.
Well, I'm very impressed. They've moved Crum into the middle of the defense, one of the fastest linebackers, I think, in the nation. Of course, Zbikowski, Jim, is an outstanding punt returner as well as being a hard-hitting safety, a guy that he likes to mix it up.
The one thing about Notre Dame, and we talked about it as the Notre Dame-Penn State game was going on, you said their time of possession the first half against Penn State was way out of whack for them, and you can't allow that.
Well, if you're going to give Notre Dame the ball 18 minutes out of 30 in the first half, your defense is going to be worn out. I mean, we've got to be able to do some things offensively and put some points on the board. You know Notre Dame is going to score some points, but we cannot. We've got to do some things offensively.
And I think, you know, Notre Dame gets this reputation with Charlie Weiss, the offensive genius, quote unquote, and yet I think the strength of their team, what holds them in games, is their defense. I think their defense maybe gets a short shrift.
Well, I think, you know, we all know they've got outstanding athletes, and they're very quick. I think they're much quicker than they were a year ago defensively. But offensively, they've got so many weapons. And, of course, Quinn is a guy that can make all the throws. And, Jim, they have a great screen game. And of course, Darius Walker is a great football player. So, and their offensive line is veteran with one exception, Sam Young, a young tackle, freshman tackle starting in there. But it's a veteran team.
As you go into this game, what's your focus for Michigan?
Well, our focus is to be balanced offensively. I think they're going to make it hard to run the football because that's what we've done best so far. But we're going to have to be able to protect and throw the football. And we've got to keep from giving up any big plays. You can't give them easy touchdowns. They're going to earn enough as it is.
And don't you dare turn it over.
Don't turn the football over.
There you go. It's Michigan Notre Dame. It's next week. Be here for it all right here on Michigan Replay.
Michigan Replay has been brought to you in part by Diet Mountain Dew. How dew does diet. By Pontiac, official performance machines of Michigan and the NCAA. By LaSalle Bank, proud to support the University of Michigan football program, LaSalle Bank, making more possible. By Gatorade Thirst Quencher. Gatorade, is it in you? And by Big Boy Restaurants. Oh boy, Big Boy, celebrating 70 years as your hometown family restaurant.